Welcome to Truth Sentinel, watching over the truth in the news. Today's date is the 13th of October, 2014. Speaking a bit quieter today as I'm staying in a hotel in Ukraine and it's quite late, so I don't want to keep anyone awake. Welcome to all listeners. Thanks for your support. Apologies for skipping a week. This will happen from time to time, as work and travel commitments sometimes create limitations on this production of this show. At some point in the future, I'm hoping that as we get sponsors and maybe some advertisers, that we'll be able to eliminate problems like that. Anyway, today's news. Putin has ordered thousands of troops stationed near the Ukrainian border to return to their bases. That's according to Russian media reports. I think there was about 18,000 soldiers on training exercise in the Rostov region, which have been asked to be pulled back. And there was a meeting between Putin and Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko on Friday, I believe, or it could be next Friday. There was a truce agreed on the 5th of September, but fighting has continued around Donetsk. There's a bit of a worry that as the winter comes along, there's going to be gas shortages if the dispute over Ukrainian territory is not resolved. The winters can be pretty cold here. Like if you actually sort of fall asleep outside, for example, maybe you had too much to drink and you fall asleep outside, you could wind up dead. The temperatures can drop to about below negative 20 anyway. And so there's a worry if the gas is cut off over the winter, then people are going to die, basically. People are dying in the east anyway. If you get the chance, I think it's a good idea to check out online, looking at photographs and videos to what actually is happening in east Ukraine, because the media has gone pretty quiet on it, but people are dying in the streets over there. You can see video and photographs of people shopping and obviously being shot by snipers. There's a video of a guy who's just bought some water, a water container. He's just walking on the street, obviously taking a shot by a sniper to the head. And this is what happens when you bring war into civilian zones. People are just going to die. And I saw another minibus blown up by a missile. Everyone dead in there, people near shops lying on the floor dead. This is what's happening, yeah? In the same country I'm in at the moment, where I am at the moment in Odessa, everything's fine at the moment, but it could spread to these regions later on. And that's what I think people need to understand, that you're talking about real people living normal lives, going to the shops, going to bars, going to clubs, and they're just ending up dead on the street. This is the result of war. Okay, just talking about Ebola, which is obviously a massive topic in the news at the moment. A healthcare worker has just tested positive in a Texas hospital. And this was one of the people who was looking after Mr. Duncan, who, after traveling from Liberia, died at the Dallas hospital on Wednesday. So you can see that it's pretty contagious, and although they've been trying to play down how contagious it is, it's obviously highly contagious, and people say that every 3 weeks the number is going to double as to how many people have got it. So I think it's going to spread. I don't know how far and how big this is going to spread, but it's not looking good at the moment, is it? Another thing I noticed in the news was the two Chinese cult murderers who were sentenced to death. This is a cult in China where a woman was just minding her own business, eating in McDonald's, and there was a cult, unfortunately, cult members on a table nearby, and they were asking people in the restaurant for their telephone number so they could try to recruit them. She refused, so the leader beat her to death with an iron bar and then just stamped repeatedly on her head. And they've been sentenced to death, with some of the other cult members being sentenced to life or having periods of time in prison. And at some point, we're going to try and do an episode on the dangers of cults. Okay, the other situation, obviously, is ISIS and Syria. You've got the Kobane situation, the town which is seems very perilously close to falling, with 500 people reported dead in the last month as the ISIS tried to take control of that town, which is on the Turkish border, and we're going to talk about that later in the episode. So I'm going to skip over the news fairly quickly today. I mean, other things that are going on in the news, you've got the Hong Kong uprising, with China insisting it's not going to change its mind on the format for elections in 2017, despite all the protests. I mean, basically China had agreed to direct elections, but wants to control over which candidates can stand. You know, I think with all our countries, we've got different forms of government, and, you know, people who live in a democracy think that they've got a better, fairer form, and to a certain extent, maybe they have, but not really that far, to be honest. I mean, if you look at the UK, it's always sort of the same parties. They always pretty much carry out the same kind of policies. And, you know, if you look at the Scotland vote, there's allegations that could have been rigged anyway, and I hope it was, because if you look at what the Scottish people may have voted to stay part of, it wouldn't make a lot of sense. So I hope it was rigged. Otherwise, people have willingly voted to be part of a system run by criminals and paedophiles. Another thing that caught my attention in the news was, or rather just on the internet in general, was I came across the former legal advisor to President Bush was presented with some scenarios as to what would be acceptable forms of torture in the law. And he was basically saying that the president could, for example, legally cause the death of an entire village if it was deemed necessary. And another situation was put to him where they said, basically, what if someone needed to be tortured for information? Would it be acceptable or legal to crush the testicles of a child whilst their Muslim parents were watching to try and obtain information from them? Would that be a legal thing for the president to order? And he basically said yes. And this was John Yoo, legal advisor to President Bush. I don't know if he's still a legal advisor, but it does give you a bit of an insight into probably some of the things they've been doing. Those who haven't heard Cameron's UN speech, or rather the end of freedom of speech, listen to this recording of what our Prime Minister Cameron said recently at the UN.
The root cause of this terrorist threat is a poisonous ideology of Islamist extremism. This is nothing to do with Islam, which is a peaceful religion which inspires countless acts of generosity every day. Islamist extremism, on the other hand, believes in using the most brutal forms of terrorism to force people to accept a warped worldview and to live in a quasi-medieval state. To defeat ISIL and organizations like it, we must defeat this ideology in all its forms. As evidence emerges about the backgrounds of those convicted of terrorist offenses, it is clear that many of them were initially influenced by preachers who claim not to encourage violence, but whose worldview can be used as a justification for it. We know this worldview, the peddling of lies, that 9/11 was somehow a Jewish plot, or that the 7/7 London attacks were staged. The idea that Muslims are persecuted all over the world as a deliberate act of Western policy. The concept of an inevitable clash of civilizations. We must be clear, to defeat the ideology of extremism, we need to deal with all forms of extremism, not just violent extremism. For governments, there are some obvious ways we can do this. We must ban preachers of hate from coming to our countries. We must proscribe organizations that incite terrorism against people at home and abroad. We must work together to take down illegal online material like the recent videos of ISIL murdering hostages. And we must stop the so-called non-violent extremists from inciting hatred and intolerance in our schools, our universities, and yes, even our prisons. Of course, some will argue that this is not compatible with free speech and intellectual inquiry. But I ask you, would we sit back and allow right-wing extremists, Nazis or Ku Klux Klansmen to recruit on our university campuses? No. So we shouldn't stand by and just allow any form of non-violent extremism. We need to argue that prophecies of a global war of religion pitting Muslims against the rest of the world, these things are nonsense. We need Muslims and their governments around the world to reclaim their religion from these sick terrorists, as so many are doing and quite rightly doing today. We need all need help and to help them with programs that channel young people away from these poisonous ideologues. And we need the strongest possible international focus on tackling this ideology.
So what's being packaged here are some relatively logical points justifying how they're going to take away freedom of speech. If they were just going to tackle people who incited people to kill, I wouldn't have so much of a problem. But comparing 9/11 conspiracy theorists with ISIS is a step too far. And they will come after everyone, basically. They proved that with the detaining of Glenn Greenwald's partner at Heathrow on terrorism charges, when clearly he had nothing to do with terrorism. Anyone who disagrees with our government will be targeted, and between ISIS and Ebola, and the scare that's being created around both of these issues, you'll see the end of most of the freedoms in the UK, with people in the public begging for these measures to be brought about. It's quite clever how they're doing it, really. Okay, so I'll let you know about our new feature, voicemail feature. It's not being used as much as I would hope, so I really would encourage you just to check out that feature. If you're not sure where it is, you should be on the Truth Sentinel YouTube channel. If you go to the top right, you'll see a little icon, and you can click on it there, an orange icon, which will take you to the voicemail. Or if you click on the About section, you'll find it there too. If you have any problems, send me an email, scottsentinel9@gmail.com. Because I'd love you to leave a message and let me know what you think about some of these issues. So I would urge almost everyone out there, just try and send a message on the voicemail. Let's have some interaction. I'm going to respond directly to your voicemail. So we do have one this week, though. Let's listen to the voicemail this week.
Hello, this is Scott again, using our new voicemail service. I haven't had many people leaving any messages this week, so I just wanted to let you know how easy it is to use. Just go to the link for the voicemail, which you can find on the About section. Record your message, maximum 1.5 minutes long. Some people may have had some technical problems. If you try a couple of times, you should be okay. You have to click on the Allow button, and if you have any problems, click on the Settings and choose the correct microphone. But try a couple of times. Occasionally I've had problems, but if I try one or two times, it usually works. So give it a go. Let me know if there's any technical problems so that we can get this feature up and running and have some real interaction between us all. So this is my message to you to try and use the voicemail service. Okay, thanks.
Last episode, we spoke to Sheila Zielinski about end times, revelations, climate change. Today, we're joined by Seth Davis and Corey Washington. Now, I met Seth through connection with Pete Wickert and the Truth is Stranger Than Fiction show, which you can find on YouTube. And we've spoken to Pete before on a recent episode. Seth is also running the Truth Alliance site to help promote truth-seeking shows like ours, and so we're grateful for him for doing that. And he's also got a Facebook page called Two Real News, where you can find out more information about what he does and about important issues that affect us all. And he writes some good articles there. Corey Washington is host of the Average Liberator show, and he's got lots of episodes talking about issues that affect people's liberties. He's still looking at conspiracy theories and world events analysis as well. In the About section on his YouTube page, he says he's just an average guy using social media to try and help the rising generation liberate itself. So go and check him out as well. We'll give more details later anyway. Let's go to the discussion. We have a kind of mutual chat between ourselves about various events that are hitting the headlines at the moment.
So we're having a mutual chat today, and we've got Seth Davis from Truth is Stranger Than Fiction, and Corey Washington from The Average Liberator. So hi, Seth. Hi, Corey.
How you guys doing?
How's it going, Scott? How you doing, Seth?
Oh, pretty good. Glad to be here.
Me too.
Glad
me
to be
too.
Here too.
So let's start off with Seth. What's the big news where you are at the moment?
Oh, right now, the fear-mongering on the TV would have you believing that Ebola is the single biggest threat in the world, and the only thing second to Ebola would probably be the fear-mongering I'm seeing right now of Russia deploying tactical nuclear arms in Crimea. People have been running around like chickens with their heads cut off over this as well.
Yeah, I hadn't heard that, actually. I'm over here in Ukraine at the moment, but I hadn't heard that, probably because I can't understand too much Russian or Ukrainian. What was that about then?
Personally, I think it's just more war propaganda, them ramping up, because Russia very well could have tactical nukes in Crimea, but this isn't exactly a surprise, because NATO has had tactical nukes in the area for a long time, with ICBMs there positioned all along the Russian border. So it's not exactly, it wouldn't be surprising if Russia had moved tactical nukes into Ukraine. However, I don't know. It really seems fishy to me. It's like the MH17 coverage that was so biased. It's like all of it. Really is all of it.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, I remember seeing that thing in the news a few weeks ago, I think, saying that a tactical nuclear weapon had been used in Ukraine. And, you know, looking at the explosion, I don't think that was a tactical nuke at all.
No, not at all. That was a regular explosion, for sure.
So I think you're right that, you know, it's just propaganda. Corey, what do you think, anyway? Have you heard much news about what's going on over here in Ukraine, where you are?
No, I actually, that was new news to me. You know, but I definitely feel like it sounds like it would be propaganda, even if it, you know, it may have been a real situation that got diffused or, you know, somehow got, dispersed. You know, at the end of the day, they're going to continue to use it and prop it up and, you know, try to use the situation for whatever they can. You know, the same thing happens over here. It's kind of just like a typical, you know, government tactic to just use the solution, the problem, and find a solution to benefit themselves. So it's all just fear mongering, you know.
Has Ukraine faded a bit from the news over there? Because I was in England about a month ago, and it was being less covered on the news over there at the time. I don't know what it's like now, but it sort of slipping out of the headlines a bit?
Yeah, it's all Ebola. There's nothing but Ebola on the news right now.
hadn't seen that little bit about them fear-mongering about stuff with the Russian tactical nukes in Crimea, it is all Ebola. All of it. It is almost, even the alternative media, it's almost become, I don't know, it's kind of starting to piss me off with the amount of how much they're covering this while ignoring all the other news. It's like suddenly the wars, the genocides around the world, the coup d'etats going on, the pretty obvious American-backed coup going on right now in Hong Kong. Or sorry, we don't call it a junta. We call it a pro-democracy protest going on in Hong Kong right now, just like in Crimea, or just like in Kiev, sorry.
Yeah, indeed. It is very hypocritical the way the West covers certain events that are going on in different countries and refer to them in a completely opposite way to how they refer to something that's in their own interests, you know.
Oh, yeah. It almost does. You'll notice that as a pattern. It's almost always the freedom fighters are really the usually CIA-backed or just American State Department-backed quote-unquote rebels, which are usually just foreign mercenaries, and then the people that are referred to as extremists, especially in the Middle East, where there are quite a few popular uprisings happening right now in North Africa, they'll call them Islamic militants or Islamic extremists, when quite often they're actually just the local militia that has taken up arms and is kicking out their U.S. or British or French-backed puppet government.
Yeah, indeed, and that's a lot to do with what's going on here in Ukraine. I mean, with the West have obviously instigated this, I believe, and they're really manipulating all different sides of the Ukrainian sort of political thought in amongst the citizens, because there's so much division in Ukraine, and they've just really made use of that and basically got people killing each other in East Ukraine. I mean, I've seen some pretty horrific videos, which they're not showing on the news so much, but you have to really go and look it out for yourself. Videos and photographs of people, citizens being shot and dead in the streets, just doing their shopping. You know, there's one photo I saw of a guy just with a big container of water. He's obviously just come back from the shop, and a sniper's just picked him off. I mean, I don't know who's doing it. It might be the Ukrainian army. It could be the pro-Russians. I don't know, but basically what happens.
Trying to stir it up. Right.
Western-backed mercenaries.
It's what they did in Kiev during the Maidan protest. They started shooting people on both sides to get people flared up. I have a feeling stuff like that's going to happen in Ferguson and St. Louis with what they're having right now. I have a feeling that's going to happen. I don't know. A lot of the big, obviously controlled protests have gone that same direction. I mean, Hong Kong right now, you'll notice they started getting violent in Hong Kong, and there's no possible way to reconcile the situation with the quote-unquote protesters, some of whom have connections to guys like Sheldon Adelson in the United States State Department. So that's a little bit suspicious. It is in Ukraine as well, because as you just stated there, there are videos all over the place of people being viciously murdered. However, that doesn't make the news, but the obviously fake ISIS beheading videos can make the news to galvanize public support for the United States, for England, or for France to get back on the ball when it comes to invasion. And it's disgusting. It's imperialism at its worst.
Yeah,
it shows how controlled things are, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it shows how they are literally controlling all these events around the world, and people are dying because of it. That's the result. I mean, it's all a big political game for them. You know, they probably sit down in offices and plan these things, but people die literally on the streets because of their decisions.
Yep, even the people that work for them, and all these people get this idea that you're working for the not necessarily for the good guys, but for the winners or the people that will eventually win, so somehow you'll succeed as well there. But almost always you end up getting turned on, because the United States has a wonderful history of doing, of setting up a puppet government and then turning against them about 6 months later. The good rebels become the bad rebels, and the bad rebels become the good rebels.
Yeah, but I mean, these days with sort of whistleblowers and all the technology that we've got, you know, some of the truth does come out. I mean, what you mentioned earlier about the snipers killing people on both sides, that was that you can actually confirm that online by listening to the phone call between Catherine Ashton, the EU foreign minister, and the Estonian foreign affairs minister, who said that's what, you know, it's all the evidence shows.
Yeah, I mean, that stuff with everybody forgets Victoria Nuland and, I can't remember that guy's name, that phone call between them, where he says F the EU and all that, just drops it. Like, they are actual gangsters. Like, people put all this stuff into, like, a gangster rap or whatever, like, these guys are gangsters. No. These people that are in power right now in the government are, quote-unquote, white-collar gangsters. They're the real deal. They're the actual mafia that really controls all this stuff. And they're moving in on other people's turf, as it were. And even though at the top with this whole idea of like a new world order thing, it does all get together in one big coalition of crap at the top. But at the same time, there is the Anglo-American bloc. There's the Russian bloc or the Eurasian bloc. And then there's the East Asian bloc. And those three do at least fight each other overtly and sometimes covertly.
No, I agree. They are gangsters and criminals, but the majority of the population, or a large majority of the population, still don't see that. They think, you know, basically, as long as they can go to the shops, watch TV, and they feel relatively safe, that they feel like these people have got their best interests at heart. But, you know, possibly they haven't. In fact, you know, you mentioned the Ebola situation, and who knows where that's going to lead to, but I've been looking a lot into eugenics lately, and it's pretty disturbing. If you, the more you look into it, the more you realize there is a possibility that they are thinking of wiping out a large percentage of the population.
Oh,
Oh, yeah.
there's not just a possibility they're thinking about it. They're not just thinking about it. They're publicly discussing this with absolutely no fear of repercussions. Because, I mean, think about it. How many times in human history you could be walking around or getting up in front of a big audience of people, a couple thousand people, and talk about how you want to kill 90% of the people that are alive on the planet right now, and somehow you aren't arrested?
Yeah, in fact, you know, that professor, I've forgotten his,
Bianca, Eric Bianca.
that's it. He got a standing ovation for saying that, doesn't he? I mean,
People crying and stuff is how beautiful it was, and it's a cult. It all, and then you realize that there's a certain amount of society that, because science is allowed to dictate morality now as much as it was during Nazi Germany, and it's disgusting. The eugenics mindset that has come out of Western quote unquote society there since the days of Darwin and Galton and Wedgwood has it's disgusting. It's racist. I mean, hell, they created racism itself through the eugenics ideology and the fact that there are different races of people and that somehow white people or Caucasoids are a higher race than black people or what Negroids or what, and it's like, give me a break. None of that's real, man. We're all one human race of people, and yet it's all this different stuff to justify why you're better than somebody or why you deserve somebody else's slice of the pie. And it really is just a system that they use to justify misanthropy. I mean, people want to push the now National Organization of Women wants to push misogyny as a big problem, and of course, like the men's rights groups want to push misandry as a problem. But the real problem is misanthropy. It's people devaluing human life and feeling as though it doesn't matter what evil they do, how absolutely cruel they can be, as long as they get what they want at the end of the day.
Indeed, yeah, Corey.
No, I agree with them 100% on that. That's it seems to be the plan. The powers that be, the left-right paradigm, the eugenicists that are really puppeteering the whole, situation are definitely playing on, the people's, faults, because we all have faults. And, they're just manipulating situations and, using it for their end game to get rid of all of us, and it's disgusting how they can come out in the open and, like you said, just say how they want to rid the world of so many people, and then, no one gets arrested, no one even mentions the fact that it's disgusting that they said it, and then, like you said, they get standing ovations. It's just completely ridiculous. And, the whole eugenics movement, from its, from its inception, it makes you question, the establishment and why things are the way they are, and why slavery was okayed by, the Roman Catholic Church, and why has there been this giant mission basically to destroy, a region of the planet, and then basically, not to get into a whole, off topic thing, but we look at Ebola, we look at where it started, we look at all of these diseases that happen to be, bioweapons, and race specific bioweapons at that, most of the time, like HIV,
Well, Ebola
AIDS.
wasn't around in Africa until after the first case of Marburg's in Germany.
Right.
So that's
And
always something to think about it as well there.
so we have to look at these situations and question, what is this attack really about? Because, the eugenics movement, it all really started as a way to exterminate, the unwanted slaves that were left behind, that were now in the communities of the 1%, you know,
Oh, yeah.
higher up people, right? And now that's where they came in with their doctrine. And it got to a point where their extermination attempts just wouldn't work because it can't work. And now that's why I feel, at least personally, that's why the plan is to just get rid of all of us. Because if you
Yeah,
can't
well, they use
exterminate.
the little division type things to try and be like to justify to the poor, uneducated Appalachian white guy that we're gonna kill a bunch of black people so it's okay, and they'll tell the fucking poor black person that it's okay, we're gonna kill a bunch of Asian people so it's no problem, and they'll tell the poor Asian person that it's okay, we're gonna go kill a bunch of people down in South America or Central America or something, so it's, nobody has anything to worry about,
Yeah,
but
but
they're
see,
killing all
like,
of us.
yeah, but see, that's true to a point, but in a way, they're still like, they're not even telling the other races anything. You know, like, there's no one, the black community gets no warning, the Asian community gets no warning, the Hispanic community gets no warning, and I mean, majority of the white community gets no warning except for the top
1%, pretty much the top of
1%.
the, or did I say the
And
top
it's,
like 4 or 5%
And
maybe?
it, you know, and it just like to me, it just raises questions to me at the, you know, what is the real reason? What's the real reason of the distorted history? Because
Yeah.
even if you look at the, you know, the inception of the United States, which if you call it the United States and not the United States of America, you're talking about a corporation, but that's a whole different conversation. But if
Yeah,
you
like
look
the
at
city of
the,
London.
if you, yeah, but if you look at the inception of that, you know, we come to realize that majority of the founding fathers were Freemasons,
And in some
and
cases, hardcore occultists as well, like Franklin in the case of Rosicrucianism, and as well as being a member of the Hellfire Club. Yeah,
right,
it's a lot less
because
clean than what people want to teach.
right, and they a lot of them secretly wore fezes. So, and you know, and this comes into, you know, history that is untold in, you know, a lot of parts of the world. But it is told in a lot of the other parts of the world, and there's these clashes. And you know, one thing that I really like to stress, and I know it seems like I'm just on this whole, you know, snowball of, you know, effect, but I'm trying to bring it back, is if we don't understand the real history, and this is even going be back before the inception of the nation,
Oh,
so we
yeah,
can get
thousands of
to a
years, yeah.
Yeah, so we can get back to a point in the world where there's just thousands of global communities and not these, you know, even nation states, you know. But
I
if we
agree.
can get back to a community-based level and understand the true history and understand, you know, the real history, real biology, real everything about humanity, then we could really live in peace and harmony. But the way everything is propagated by these eugenicists, they don't even teach us real biology. They
Yeah.
don't really teach us how people's bodies really work. They don't even teach us a lot of things that, you know, where we can understand that. So there are differences in humans because the human beings are multi, you know, multiracial, multifaceted
Well, I'd say
individuals.
multi-ethnic, not multiracial, because we're all technically the
Yeah,
human
well, right,
race
yeah,
anyway,
race
but
isn't,
yeah.
yeah, race isn't real, but you know, we, at the end of the day, it all just comes down to biology, and our biologies are different at the end of the day. And until people can understand that fact, in my opinion, and then just embrace that fact, so there's not that mental, you know, that mental retardation or those questions that you can't get answered because there's no one to ask those questions because no one's taught those answers, then everything's going to be chaos. People are going to continue to kill each other. There's going to be crime. There's going to be people that want to gain control to seek power to destroy because people don't even really know who they are, you know?
Well, the
So.
irony that the people that are most attracted to power are the people that should like least deserve power is kind of a paradox there.
And people who need to understand who they are so they don't elect those type of people into power. But they don't give out the complete information because they're the eugenicists, and that's why they want to kill us, because unless they kill all of us, then they will
They're
never
gonna
have
know.
supreme control. Exactly. Because someone will always know. And that's why they want to kill us all.
I just got a chill run down my back when you said that. That's pretty much it too.
And there's
It's just
another irony that they think they're the best and they want to kill everyone else. But can you imagine a world where it's only them that are left? They're
oh, they tear
actually
each other apart.
actually the
They couldn't
worst
live.
kind of people. They actually think, you know, they're the higher intelligence, you know, physically better, but They're actually the worst kind of people. It's been proven by their actions.
Well, yeah, pedophiles and morons. I mean, let's not forget, what was that? Who was that? I believe that was young David Rockefeller, or what was that? Yeah, I believe that was on Alex Jones, the younger that they had him on there, and he said something about, was it Mars being closer to the sun than the Earth or something like that? And it was just like, wait, what?
Maybe there's a different Mars that we're just not told about.
Yeah, and I'm just saying there that these people are like multi-billionaires and have all this power and claim to be so superior, yet this guy's a freaking moron.
Yeah.
I mean, they think because they went to the best schools, that automatically makes them more intelligent, but it doesn't. It just means that maybe because you've had more personal attention, smaller class sizes, you've probably accumulated more information, but that's all. You're not actually more intelligent.
Or maybe it's because their dad would have their instructors murdered if they didn't give them straight A's.
Yep. Oh, you get it. I mean, that's what you were just talking about before there, Corey. The political nature of a lot of this stuff, that it's, the education system itself is completely political by nature. I mean, look at how much stuff in school that people are taught. I mean, regardless of your religious denomination, their affiliation, or lack thereof, you got to admit, with the evolution, Darwinian stuff, and eugenics being taught in school, that's a little bit much rather than waiting for, like, solid information. And similarly with climate change and global warming and all that, it's political hype, and I mean, it really has become all of it. I mean, our biology, our science itself is completely political. Our systems of thought, our systems of speech have become extremely political. I mean, the very definition of political correctness. Everything about our history, all of it is political correctness. I mean, God forbid anybody acknowledge that there's good and bad in this world. I mean, I would just get a chance to say this here. It's like I was trying to explain to people when, I mean, I think you guys remember this when they had the thing out of, what was it, the Kurdish, the PKK, women warriors or whatever they had going out there killing the ISIS people, because if they get killed by a woman, then they go to hell, which actually has nothing to do with any kind of Islamic dogma or doctrine at all, but they just made that up for a nice Western news story. And I was trying to explain to people that while ISIS, those of them that are on the ground that aren't actually just Western contractors or whatever, that are actual just people that have been brainwashed on the ground to fight for Western contractors, are they're bad people. But at the same time, the PKK are like hardcore communist extremists that kill people and blow up stuff all the time, especially in Turkey. And yet, no, it's just the people like that left-right paradigm, that easy to pick a good guy and a bad guy. And the fact is, when it comes to government, they're all really bad guys. There's nobody that's really trustworthy that's in a point of power like that, because the people that gravitate to that sort of career are corrupt morally, physically, whatever you want to say, emotionally, they're completely corrupt.
Indeed they are. I mean, I've been looking at alternative systems of government. What do you guys think about the anarchy? I mean, I was always led to believe that anarchy was chaos, basically, but if you look more into it, you can see it's not actually chaos. It's still organized society. It just means that the power has been transferred to people. Have you looked into anarchy at all, and what do you think about it?
Corey, you want to take this first?
Yeah, sure. I mean, me and my buddy Mike Pichesny, he's the host of one of the hosts of the Rundown Live, we talk about this all the time, how as days go by, we become more and more anarchists because you just get fed up of the system. And it's not like, it's not even a bad thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing. There's just that stigma that's been put on anarchy by the establishment, because that's what the establishment does. Anything that could be good and is a good idea, they want to demonize so people don't gravitate towards those ideas, those ideologies. You know, we've seen it with, you know, in the Liberty Movement, it being co-opted, it being demonized, the likes of Alex Jones. We see it in the past, you know, parties like the Black Panther Party, the original Black Panther Party, not the new Black Panther Party.
Yeah, the
Larry Yes, exactly. You know, the good old days. But, you know, that's just what's going to happen. But, you know, I lean more and more towards anarchy because at the end of the day, I know I'm a good person And I know I don't need anybody to oversee what I'm doing for me to be able to live my life, you know? And at the end of the day, I would rather have, you know, me and my neighbors deal with the situation than be policed by, you know, people that are just trying to, you know, get revenue from me or kill me, you know, at the end of the day. I mean, a lot of people don't really understand because they don't necessarily deal with the police as much as some other people may deal with the police, but like me, I encounter the police a lot, you know.
As a former former long hair there in a state where smoking pot's the big thing, I can definitely attest to the police on that one.
And it just gets ridiculous to a point where it's like, why are you messing with me? I'm not doing anything.
Yeah, don't you have a real job? Seriously, at
did
this
you
point,
man, did you like... guys see that video of the guy the police? Police guy who asked that guy for his license, and he went to get it, and he shot him. Mm-hmm. Did you see that video?
Yeah, that was around the way. I actually live right on the border of Wisconsin and Illinois. I'm in Wisconsin, but I'm pretty sure where that guy was, it was only about 45 minutes away from where I am. And I mean, cops in this area are just gangsters. They're told to act the way they act. I mean, they're told to deal with situations however they deem fit, and they'll get backed up by the police chiefs and everything. I actually had a sit-down meeting with the chief of police here in the city where I'm at, and you know, I had to go through loops and boundaries to get the conversation. But really, I just wanted to know, you know, from his words, since you know he's the commander in chief for the police force. So every single time I get randomly stopped, are you going to have to continue to ask me if I have drugs and bring extra squad cars and dogs and waste my time to find nothing?
And this happens. Waste people's money. That, like, just give me a break, man.
Exactly. And this has happened to me time and time and time again, to the point where I was just fed up with it. I was with my girl at the time when she was actually 8 months pregnant. And then they're still pulling us out. It was about to be winter time. It was cold and all of this stuff. And I got fed up, you know, and that's why I'm at the point where I'm just tired of the state. I don't want to pay money. I'm forced to pay money so these guys can be funded so I can be harassed. And the chief said it's constitutional.
Let's be completely blunt. Many of these cops, and I don't know how it is for Scott there in the UK and everything. I know you're in Ukraine right now, but as far as like local cops and whatnot, but Corey, I guarantee you got a pretty similar outlook as myself there. A lot of these cops rolling around in their squad cars or sitting there on the side of the road are watching porn on their laptops. They aren't even working, for God's sake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And seriously, unless they're pulling you over to harass you or beat up your girlfriend or freaking, like that, was it that, was that a commissioner or a police chief in Illinois there that stuck the gun in the guy's mouth during a traffic stop and tased him in the crotch?
Pretty sure it was the chief.
Yeah, and it's just like, yep, if you got that kind of behavior at the top, what the hell do you expect people to do at the bottom? I mean, that's their example of what to
that's
look
how
up
you get
to
the top nowadays, though. It's disgusting.
Oh, yeah. These, I mean, you know, Douglas Dietrich, Pete had him on a couple days ago on a Thursday evening there, and as he brought up, a lot of people get offended by it, but bringing up in the military the prevalence of stuff like pedophilia and rape and everything, and it's pretty big, and you'd be surprised how big it is among the police force and among a congressman and a system
of
judges and stuff.
Absolutely. We've got a big problem with that in the UK at the moment.
They've shut up about that a lot.
It's being covered
totally
up.
Plans supposedly go all the way up to the royal family or whatnot.
Absolutely, yeah, but I mean, and it's basically being covered up because they can't have the royal family or top politicians, even previous prime ministers, being brought into this. They keep trying to bring someone in to conduct an investigation, but the person they bring in is so obviously on their side that the
people
could just reject them.
Well, half the time it's an actual pedophile that they send to investigate people for pedophilia.
Well, I feel like they want to cover it up so bad, though, because it'll just lead to the ultimate dark setting, you know. It's not just pedophilia, I have a feeling.
Oh, yes, satanic like sacrifice or whatever to that point, yeah. No, I feel you. There's been more than enough stuff come out. Isn't there just dead bodies randomly found on royal property all the time?
Yeah, it's not just pedophilia. It's there's children dying as a result of this, because the people that are being involved are famous and recognizable, yeah. and they can't take the chance that they're going to get caught.
Well, a lot of people out here will look at that as a terrible thing, and I'm not saying it's not. It is. It's just think about it. And Corey can work with me here on this one. As far as somebody from the United States here, the torture they did in places like Abu Ghraib or Guantanamo Bay, where they're raping people's kids in front of them and stuff, and using battery acid to rape little kids. I mean, or was it crushing kids' testicles in front of their parents with like little clamps and stuff like that?
Wow.
Yeah, well, that's the United States. That's our government. Mm-hmm. I guarantee you in England they're doing similar stuff in France and Germany and all that.
They care
Russia,
about
Russia, China, whatever, and that's passé. And the fact that that's become passé makes me so sick. And then people, I've noticed, will throw out, especially in the system, if somebody's compromised, that's a pedophile, like, let's say, what's his face, Jerry Sandusky, or whatever like that, they'll vilify the crap out of them in the media. But the fact is, we have politicians that approve of people crushing children's testicles in front of their parents to get them to talk. We have a government that allows people to sodomize people with chemical glow sticks and take pictures of it and have them piled up in big naked piles and everything. And we literally live in a system that's run by, may as well, it is run by the devil. I mean, really, who else could you think of that could come up with this crap of assaulting children to get information because, oh, those terrorists, they might have. And they use the 24 Jack Bauer thing to justify it of, he's got codes that might save U.S. lives if we get them, so we'll do whatever we've got to do. And it pisses me off to a level that and I've noticed the average American and the average Brit or whatever, the average German, the average Italian, the average Frenchman, the average Russian, the average Chinaman understand that their government is not trustworthy, that their government also does not represent them. And I'd like to kind of get people to realize that, and I push that a lot, but that there is a difference between a local populist people and their government. You and I have nothing to do with the actions of the United States government, of the evils that they've committed allegedly in our names. Scott has nothing to do with the evil that's been committed by the UK government allegedly in his name. I mean,
it's
terrible.
And I think that's also a bit where eugenics comes from, because eugenics sort of look at humans on the earth and the terrible things they've done to the planet, and they blame it on the entire population and say we need to cull the population. But it's actually the eugenicists, the people at the top, that are responsible for most of the evil in the world.
Yep, the warmongers, the banksters, the genocidal maniacs. I mean, look at what is it, that ZMAP, they already had that out, the genetically engineered Monsanto vaccine by the time Ebola rolled on out. It's always got to be a money-making scam somewhere along the lines of taking natural resources, taking whatever. And I think in the case of Africa, as much as there is a true hatred of black people among some of these elites, I believe that a lot of what AFRICOM and all that is just the furthering of the American empire and the taking over of a land that has large amount
resources.
Of undeveloped natural resources. Yep,
it's the most great. Natural,
I mean,
resources
right now,
in the world, and it's
right
not
now,
just
it's a
America.
Proxy war with the United States as far as in Africa right now. A lot of people don't seem to realize that almost all of these revolutions that might not be backed by the United States that are being promoted as some bad thing or whatever or vilified sometimes are indigenous populist movements there with the people that it's completely organic, real support. And in other cases, it's Russian or Chinese interventionism, that they're doing the same thing the United States does in other places. But of course, you know, it's portrayed in a positive light for them as well. It's one of the things I try to put out there, of that there are no clean players, and this is a very dangerous game these people are playing.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you too what you thought of some of these looking into eugenics. I've come across a lot of these big organizations like the World Health Organization, the World Wildlife Fund, the UN, UNESCO. And it seems to me that maybe they're not actually doing what they're supposed to do, and that they may have sort of eugenic agendas, and they're doing stuff that's maybe not at all like what people think they're supposed to be there for. I mean, the UN, for example, I saw a report on the BBC the other day, and they were reporting that there's going to be a massacre on the Turkish Iraq border.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, well, surely they're supposed to be the world security force. Are they just going to stand by like they've done in the past and just watch it happen? Or are they going to do something about it? And then the World Health Organization, the World Wildlife Fund, it seems to me they actually could be partly responsible for introducing Ebola to some areas to carry out their eugenics program.
And making endangered species extinct as well. It's the irony that whatever it really is, a system of lies that does, I guess you could say, gets to a biblical or a religious sort of a thing of a system based on truth, and what we're doing here of like the Truth Alliance or Truth Sentinel. I mean, granted, they're Corey, they're average liberator, but I mean, he's still truth oriented. That's the whole thing of a system based on truth versus a system based on lies. And the system based on lies, it's all of it's a lie.
It is a lie. I mean, the World Wildlife Fund was headed up by Prince Philip up until the late 90s, I believe. And Prince Philip and the royal family are always the face of the World Wildlife Fund and conserving and looking after animals throughout the world. And yet they go around shooting most of them and endangered
yep.
species as well. I mean,
yep.
they regularly go out on hunting trips shooting endangered species. There's a documented story of Prince Philip shooting a very rare rhino where there was only about 250 left in the world. And yet he's the face of the World Wildlife Fund. It's just, it is lies.
It's
just
okay
lies.
For him to do it. He's a royalty. He's better than you or I because of who his ancestors were, obviously. I mean, come on.
But then you've got the media machine telling the public that the royal family are amazing and fantastic and never do anything wrong. And
even people here get on that, Scott. I can only imagine what it's like in the UK, man.
Yeah, because it's disgusting over here. There's the ladies with the flags and the plates, and they wear their
little
hats.
Yeah, I know the ladies here overall have far more of an affinity to the royal family than guys do.
They like the idea of the royal family, of what they could
the
be, rather
thing,
than
I
the actual
they all want to
what
be
they
a
are.
Princess.
They, exactly, yeah. And that's been sold to everyone by Disney, haven't it? Hasn't it, really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hell yeah. And this idea that, it's like, well, princess is all this idea that there are people that just because of who they are, that they have divine right should rule over you because my grandfather was King George, what it doesn't. I don't care, man. I don't care if you're. I don't believe really any place is truly free until their royalty is gone. And I think the United States, unfortunately, we just have a new royalty here. I mean, it's become its own aristocracy and whatnot of the Clintons, the Obamas, and the Bushes. As far as like a, in fact, not even really the Obamas. It's more or less the Clintons and the Bushes and their little hegemony they've had for like the last 30 years. And they're just middle management, I understand, but they're still pretty high up middle management compared to most of what you or I would ever be exposed to.
Yeah, I was going to ask both
Especially
of you
Bush
actually.
Senior. Bush Senior is pretty evil.
I was going to ask both of you actually what you knew about Fort Detrick and what goes on there with the bioweapons research. And some people have said that AIDS was made there and Ebola was made there as a bioweapon. Do you think there's any truth into that? Do you know anything about that at all?
I personally do not, but I also do not put it past them. And
I know a little bit on it, but I, like Corey said there, I wouldn't put it past them at any point. In fact, that most of what you'll come to understand is really easy to find, actually. It's kind of like DARPA, how all these like insane weapons and everything you can find under the auspices of defense. Well, similarly, you can find all these terrible bioweapons and all these bio-research stuff and everything under the auspices of bio-research or bio-warfare research defense. And thus, it's all under the auspices of we're defending against the possibility that eventually there could be some sort of problem like this. So we have to so that in case somebody else does, we have a cure for it, or vice versa. We have to weaponize the mousepox. So that instead of killing, what, like 20% of the people that get it, the new mouse pox will kill like 90%+ of the people that get it. I mean, that's all they do. The fact that there are people that are hired by our government in Europe, in the United States, in Asia, all over, that do nothing but create diseases and viruses that have like a 90%+ kill ratio.
In level 2 science facilities at that.
Oh, God, dude, don't even get me started on
yeah,
that as far
doors.
As the Ebola stuff. And I, the one thing that was weird, I knew I was on the cusp with this new stuff once it came to the Ebola patients going to Atlanta, is that I already had put together, and I'd already talked to Pete about it, of the Kasim Reed connection and Bilderberg and all that, that they had the problem of Africa there, and then that was before really the huge Ebola scare of late there. And I thought that was kind of interesting that they move him there, and that this, you got the CDC, you've got all this stuff set up together, the Alcoa, the head there when it comes to the aluminum production and everything. That guy was at Bilderberg as well. I just always figured aluminum always runs with vaccines, as that's one of the major preservatives or whatever within vaccines. Thought that was kind of interesting that those two guys are together at the same thing, and then they're talking about the problem of Africa, and then, you know, about a month later, suddenly people start showing up with Ebola all over the place, and then about a couple weeks after that, these guys get shipped to a level 2. It really is just an open college campus medical facility that is in no way at all. Even some of those places in Africa are better prepared for the Ebola stuff than those guys are there. And they're flushing, in some cases, actual Ebola-contaminated medical waste that is going into the water supply, that the Ebola particulates themselves are so fine that most of the filtration methods they use to recycle the water is just going to literally deliver up Ebola-contaminated water to people. I mean, didn't they have that thing there of, who was that? GlaxoSmithKline or somebody putting live poliovirus into people's water?
Well, and they put all kinds of stuff in our water anyway, don't they?
Fluoride. That's fluoride. Right.
Yeah, I mean, I watched a documentary about that because I was slightly skeptical. You know, I mean, I've been drinking water all my life, but if you look into it, it doesn't make any sense. It's kind of like an acid that can burn through concrete. Why would you add it to water? It doesn't make any sense at all.
Why would you even put it in your toothpaste? Put on your teeth? Why the hell would you? And people are like, oh, because it reduces stuff. I'm like, yeah, because it's rotting the enamel off of your teeth.
Yeah.
It's literally eating it away to the point that that's, I can't remember who it was that took it out to a long-term study that found that, yeah, you do get less cavities overall because you have less teeth overall if you use fluoride or sodium fluoride as a topical solution for your teeth. And you can only imagine, and it tells you on the things there, don't swallow it, don't swallow it. Whatever you do, if you swallow it, call Poison Control Center and all this. And yeah, they're like, oh, no, you need to drink it. And especially kids. Kids need to drink it more than anybody. It's like pregnant women with vaccines here in the States. They used to tell pregnant women to not get any vaccine at all, period, because it could brain damage the kid and it could cause a miscarriage, which could in turn kill them. And now they're like, oh, no, you need twice as many vaccines. In fact, you need flu shots and all this stuff. And it's a culture of death that's become so open and so, it's kind of like what we were talking about before there, where now I saw that story of the lady with terminal cancer that they're promoting all over the news there, of she wants to kill herself, and yeah, you should kill yourself too. In fact, death panels are good, killing yourself is good, you know, euthanasia is good, abortion is good, all this stuff, where we're a culture of death cumulatively. I mean, back in, 2013, they had numbers like between 1 and 2 billion people just since Roe v. Wade killed by abortion. Just since Roe v. Wade, that's since like the 70s, that's about 50 years there of, a little bit over 50 years, almost 60, of abortion, and we're talking between 1 and 2 billion people that aren't on this planet. That's not including war, that's not including the famine, that's not including government experiments from the EPA or CDC or whoever, putting like diesel fumes in with little kids to brain damage them or kill them or cutting off oxygen to kids. It's not including any of that. Just abortion between 1 and 2 billion people.
And there's a lot of propaganda going around that we all should kill ourselves because, you know, we're a virus upon the earth. And I've seen lots of it, and it's coming from organizations like the World Wildlife Fund,
yep,
saying that half the animals have been wiped out since we've been here.
Which is all lies.
Yeah, it's lies. Really, it's complete lies. And, the Green Movement. I even heard someone from the Green Movement saying that he would gladly kill himself,
yep,
if hundreds of thousands or millions would join him.
I think that was Eric Bianca as well there, saying he and his family have made the dedication, decided to, they're going to die. They've volunteered for it. And all
I
that.
Have to
and
say, like, yeah. if they want to do that, and I mean, they make the conscious decision.
Well, depending on how young that guy's kids are,
they have the rights.
He's nobody to be volunteering them for anything and kind of should be arrested and have his kids taken away,
yeah,
for even suggesting something like that. Because if his kids are like under the age of, let's say, like 12 or something, you know, business signing them up for some freaking psycho suicide pact. just because you're a weirdo Gaia worshiper. And I've noticed that Sheila Zielinski brought that up on your show the other day there, Scott.
That's right,
the Gaia worship thing. And that is huge. You'll notice that with the people that want to kill everybody. All worship Mother Earth, Mother Earth. Yes, Mother Earth. I'm like, but what is Mother Earth, if Mother Earth is so great, want us all to die? Why? That doesn't really mesh there
for
me.
It's a form of mind control, I think.
Yeah, it's a form of self-hatred, that they can get you to want to kill yourself, which is what they want, because they hate you.
They hate you for
who you are.
I think we should get people like Eric Pianka, Prince Philip, Prince Bernard, I think Prince Bernard's already dead, actually. Bill Gates, David Attenborough, and they can go and work on the Ebola ward if things do get out of control.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, Michael Rivera says all these guys that do the warmongering, set them up with their bright orange jumpsuit, a parachute, a rifle, and a helmet and stuff, and just send them out. You guys want to fight that bad? Go do it. Well, I say similarly with these guys with their eugenics stuff. If you want everybody to die so bad, then volunteer, man.
I think that should really seriously be implemented. I mean, if these politicians had to literally go out and fight ISIS themselves, I think all their policies would change dramatically, wouldn't they?
Yeah. Well, as bad as you've noticed things in world history as far as leadership, when that used to be a thing, but when leaders would actually lead their men, there is a reason they're called a leader, is because they're at the front of the pack there. They're not standing a few miles back watching out of field reports and whatnot, finding out what's going on the battlefield. I've noticed the more detached people have become from the violence itself, the worse the violence has gotten. And drones and robotics and like bombing programs and have only exacerbated that and made it even more apparent that the detachment from the actual physical violence itself actually creates an atmosphere where it's kosher, it's cool, it's all right to have uber violence, to murder people, to massacre a whole village of people just to get one alleged Al-Qaeda terrorist. And you almost always notice whenever there's a large body count with these people in the Middle East as far as drone strikes and everything, they'll always say, it's okay. One of the guys that we got was, he knew about 9/11 beforehand, or they'll bring up 9/11 or Osama bin Laden or Al-Qaeda, and suddenly it's okay.
50-plus civilians dead for this one guy, though.
Oh, yeah, but isn't that worth it? I mean, don't you sleep better at the end of the day knowing that whatever, everybody
if it's in the whole
village there is dead because what? Of one guy that people that lie to you on a regular basis happen to tell you are affiliated with Al-Qaeda.
Whatever we need to do so we can have our freedom over here.
Hey, man, freedom ain't free.
One reason why I think they shouldn't censor the news so much, because, you know, people don't like to watch people dying on the street, you know, and what's literally happened. But I think I think you have to. You can't just turn away from it. I know people want to eat their dinner and, you know, they don't want their children to see it. But if you don't see it, you're not going to be able to have a proper opinion about the situation.
Yeah, and to get back to hate to have to bring him up and everything again, be like I'm biting on him or something there. But that that Michael Rivero guy has something that brings up the fact that, like, not only do people not trust the media because of all the lies and everything, but this detachment from the violence and all that. There are people that will ask him, be like, "Oh, why do you show the pictures of the dead Palestinian kids and all? Why is that a big deal to you and everything? Why can't you just take it off? It's offensive or whatever." No, the offensiveness isn't from the pictures themselves. The offensiveness. What we're talking right here, if we're to start using four-letter words and potty mouth language and stuff like that isn't offensive. Murdering people is offensive.
Mm.
Genociding people is offensive. And I don't care if that's what the Israeli government's doing to the Palestinians in Palestine there or whatever, in Gaza. I don't care if that's what U.S.-backed forces of, like, ISIS and all that are doing in Iraq. I don't care if that's what Russian forces are doing in Chechnya or whatever. It's not right. It's not okay.
It's not, no. I was going to ask you guys as well. It was quite scary in the last week or so in the UK. We had David Cameron stand up, and you really should listen to his speech that he did at the UN.
I remember. I know what you're going to talk about already. I know.
It was frightening. I just couldn't believe it, and yet, there was some coverage of it on the mainstream press, but people, I'm just shocked that people aren't up in arms. He basically stood up and compared people who believe in 9/11 conspiracy theories and people with non-violent views, extremist, and his interpretation of extremist is very different to mine, I think. But we're basically going to have to target them. The government are going to have to target people like that, shut down their internet accounts. So I can't see my show going on for too long. But basically, they're talking about bringing in new laws next year. They stood up and gave a raft of new laws that are coming in.
I don't know about your living situation there or whatever, Scott, but I really would suggest moving out here to the state. Doesn't really matter where a whole lot. Personally, I'd suggest out here towards more like the West Coast or whatever. But honestly, as long as you're in the States, we need more people like you here, man. We need less of the brain-dead, self-propelled stomach automatons out there that are willing to vote for whatever, and we need more people that are like-minded here in the States, and we definitely use you, man.
Well, I'd love to, but it's actually not as easy to get for me to move over to the States. It's always looked as though it's quite difficult actually to get a visa.
Mexico and come over illegally, Scott.
Yeah, come over the border.
Yeah.
Rescue us all with all of your benefits. You get there and everything.
Get you a new name,
get a
tan, for 80
draw
bucks.
Your mustache, you'll be fine.
Yeah, no, because it does look like the UK is becoming quite a scary place. I'll have to find somewhere else to live.
When he compared everybody, truthers, I guess we can just, put that label. When he said that, I remember
so much.
It's just completely ridiculous. And the sad thing about it is people are going to, latch onto that and say, yes, we need to write legislation. Please, please, masters, please get these crazy people out of here.
This is the thing. They'd actually get public support for some of their ridiculous ideas. Like with the Ebola situation now, people are demanding that the government bring in authoritarian laws.
Yeah.
People are demanding the very things that the government want to bring in. They're quite clever in that way.
I think that Dietrich guy brought that up as well, that all of this fear-mongering on Ebola actually makes it worse. So then people respond with approval for the draconian laws that come in and destroy rights and everything because they're so much more afraid of Ebola than they are the police state.
Yeah.
And it's really, truly government authoritarianism, tyranny is a thousandfold more of a threat than Ebola. And I mean, it's just, there's so much stuff that's such a big deal that is completely ignored right now that whatever. I mean, the cops kill, the real report there of what cops here in the U.S. kill yearly isn't something like 400. It's actually only about 4% of police departments, and it was voluntary, participated in that particular study there. It's actually, by the numbers, more about like 10,000, and that's just what's reported. So I'd say that's a little bit bigger of a deal than Ebola, personally. It's cops becoming militarized, cops running around with sound cannons and the nice new guns that are like laser lights that blind you temporarily, or whatever the radiation cannons that they use to just literally cook you as a crowd. They're cooking you with radiation, but it's the cops, so it's all good, whatever.
They're there to protect us with their radiation cannons and their sound cannons piercing our eardrums, and the rubber bullets, those are loving too.
How can you even, like, pretend that you're there to protect and serve with radiate? How the hell do you protect somebody or even pretend under the auspices of being, like, a peace officer when you have a cannon that shoots radiation at people?
They
like, what kind of crazy
ISIS.
Science fiction crap is that?
They need it for ISIS.
Yeah.
It's scary. People are just brainwashed, People are watching all of these MSNBCs, these Fox News, broadcasts. And they're just brainwashed by the manipulation, They think ISIS is right around the corner. They know that the border's open. So, they have the extreme right-wingists saying, oh, well, the border's right open. And ISIS is, we got to do something about ISIS. We got to bomb ISIS. They're going to come over the border. Everybody's freaking out.
I've even
seen
Rand Paul do that. And I've actually, that's something I brought up with Pete and Dan Bedondi, I think, brought up as well, too, is that Rand Paul has lost me. All the way. And in fact, the entire Republican Party, I'm just going to put it on the line there, has lost me. Libertarian or third party, independent or whatever, is the only way to go at this point. The Republican Party is every bit as defunct as the Democratic Party, and I get really tired of people in the alternative media treating establishment Republicans. Rand Paul and Ted Cruz, do not mistake me, are establishment Republicans. I'm tired of people going to them being like, oh, no, it's all right. When I've heard people bring up, and I think you spoke to this in, I think it was a couple weeks ago on one of your shows there, Corey, was, that they're trying to push the black Muslim thing as they did with that guy that allegedly beheaded that woman with a little knife. And we can get into that later on its own thing, because you know what I mean? Beheading somebody with a little knife is not exactly easy. Especially what if somebody's just laying there while you cut through their spinal column with a knife? Like, I mean, whatever.
Seconds in a foyer of a building.
Because cutting people's heads off is so easy, right? That's not why those guys develop specific kinds of swords after hundreds of years to specifically cut people's heads off, because it's not freaking easy.
Exactly.
But they're trying to push that whole meme there to be able to like get a lot of these very hardcore, mainline, right-winger type people that are, let's be honest, are for the most part xenophobic, as I'll get out, to try and fill up the concentration camps. I mean, I'm sorry, FEMA camps. I mean, sorry, internment camps. I mean, sorry, you know, freedom camps.
Freedom camps, liberty camps.
Liberty camps. Yeah, got it. Try and fill those up, because at first I know they're going to prime them, like priming the pump with illegal immigrants. Or illegal aliens, whatever, a thought crime, they're even saying that. But then they're going to try and fill them up with black Muslims to try and push this thing of, like, pretty much just divide and conquer, and then they're going to switch the meme with the whatever white conservative rural Americans with the Tea Party and all this crap.
Yeah, it'll be easy to zero in on them after that, because they'll have no quote-unquote allies, you know?
Yeah, well, that's the point of taking it piece by piece by piece, and that kind of goes with that eugenics thing we were saying earlier, where it doesn't like that necessarily work like that on a worldwide level, but here in the States, it's a great example of that. They have a certain paradigm they push to poor black people or whatever, and a certain paradigm they push to poor white people and all this, and it's all just playing people off against each other. Mm-hmm. That, like, because they don't give a shit about you at the end of the day, whether or not you're black or white. You're not in the club. I mean, Al Sharpton doesn't give a crap about you individually because you're a poor black man in the United States. Just like John McCain could give a shit about me as a poor white guy in the United States.
No. There's people that don't give a shit about them because they're in a higher up club than them. Yep. You know, it's just, you know, pyramid scheme at the end of the day.
Oh, always, always, always. And those guys that we see at the top aren't even at the top. The people at the top are even more pathetic, are even more disgusting, are even more physically debilitated in many cases because of inbreeding. And that's something that's a whole other show we could go over sometime there, the eugenic thing, and the fact that these people literally believe that they could create a race of godmen or whatever, part angelic beings, essentially, by inbreeding. By Galton, I believe Huxley, Thomas Henry Huxley was the only one that didn't participate actively, other than supporting the theories there, was Darwin, Galton, and Wedgwood, all three cousins, all marrying their respective cousins, the other people's respective sisters or whatnot. Just absolutely disgusting to try and make a race of supermen. The truth is stranger than fiction. That's not just the name of the show for Pete there and everything. That really is the truth. Is because it's crazy. I mean, anyways, whatever. Back to the ISIS deal and the way that it's a fear-mongering thing. I'm going to go over this later on in the afternoon here with Pete on Truth is Stranger Than Fiction tonight. I'm going to be last guest up with an article I wrote. And I'll send it to you, Corey, because I realized I hadn't sent it to you. I'd already sent it to Scott. But that thing on, Coruscant, Setting the Record Straight. Mm. But the fact that not only is Coruscant itself named after a historic region of Persia, not actually tied to anything in reality, and the Jabhat al-Nusra guys, the al-Nusra front guys, say that they have no idea what Coruscant is, who that is, what the hell the State Department people are talking about. And we have headlines up here out of everything from Russia Today to like CNN about how Coruscant is attacking Coruscant and all this stuff. And I go piece by piece here, step by step, all the way from the inception with in the days of the Mujahideen and like Operation was Operation Cyclone and everything, from like technically it goes back to the days of the 70s, late 70s, early 80s, of the days of like Jimmy Carter and Zbigniew Brzezinski and stuff, but it goes all the way into the late 80s, early 90s with Operation Cyclone, and then the beginnings of stuff under Clinton, the end of the Bush senior administration, and then just keeps going. I mean, you've got guys like what's his face? Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, the al-Qaeda guy, who actually is very obvious, and you can just go look this up, is like affiliated with the CIA and all this, just like, what the hell is his name, that al-Zawahiri or bin Laden or any of these guys. Almost all of them are connected into the CIA through like using foreign proxies to overthrow like Russian proxies in countries. Because in the case of the Mujahideen, they were putting extreme Muslims there in Afghanistan and Pakistan to overthrow the local Russian communist government, which they did. They did. And that's pretty similar to what's happening really all over the world. I mean, really, all this stuff that's happening right now with the PKK is a great example. That those guys are backed by Russia. As much as we've been trying to put the Kurds up there as this big cool thing and everything, it actually gets really dirty because you have the communists or Leninist Marxist PKK or the Kurds that are working for Kurdistan there, who at the same time are tied in with Turkey, ironically, who are supposedly the enemies there, but are also tied in with Russia, and thus are also tied in with like the Syrian government and all that, and Turkey, with the Turkish Alawites are tied in with Assad, and Assad supporters of Turkish Alawites. And it just, it gets even dirtier and dirtier over time to the point you realize that at the top, there is no whatever struggle between these people. It's just the people on the ground. That's why the only people that suffer through all of this stuff are the average people on the ground that are losing their wives, that are losing their husbands, that are losing their children, that are losing their parents, that are losing their aunts and uncles and cousins and friends and just people they just know, just their entire country is just falling apart before their eyes because the United States wants to try and do a power play, or that Israel wants to try and do a power play in the Middle East, or Saudi Arabia wants to do a power play in the Middle East, or Turkey, or Qatar, or even Iran. Because as much as I've noticed people, if you're quote-unquote against the Anglo-American establishment, suddenly you're pro-Russia or pro-Iran or pro-China. None of those groups are innocent either. All those people have done evil, evil stuff in the Middle East to try and just take another chunk of the pie. And the average person's life there doesn't mean anything to them. And it's terrible. It's absolutely terrible. We've got guys that are running things like now, right now, like, what's his face? John McCain, who when he met with those guys, they call the leadership of ISIS or whatever, that they're promoting that ISIS allegedly fights the FSA and the Jabhat al-Nusra. Well, the head of ISIS allegedly, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, is a CIA / Mossad agent, is actually originally a Mossad, Shimon Elliott, but then switched over essentially and became an affiliate of the Central Intelligence Agency, and somehow nobody notices that he's in that picture with John McCain, and nobody notices that one of the other guys in that picture is the head of the FSA, the quote free Syrian army. And so it's like, none of these guys are really fighting, and then ISIS or whatever, John McCain defends them against Rand Paul or whatever. Have you ever met ISIS? Have you ever talked to them? These are good guys, yeah. And all this just crap. It's just pure crap. So there is no real struggle between any of these groups, and I think it was a Syrian girl brought up a pretty good point of why, if these guys are really extreme Muslims or whatever, have none of them threatened Israel? I think that's kind of interesting. Nobody's threatened Israeli security. Nobody's threatened any Israeli interests in
that one time.
And in fact, Jabhat al-Nusra, I don't know about the FSA, but I know about Jabhat al-Nusra, receives medical aid from the Israelis and has frequently gone back across to the, the Israeli border there, which is kind of a disputed region in the Golan Heights there in Syria, and have sought out the Israeli military for aid. And that the Syrian government has actually been attacked by Israel when they pursue the al-Nusra people. So it's kind of different to see how that works there. And I know a lot of people act like, yeah, just bring that up so I'm anti-Jew or whatever, but it's give me a break. It's a government.
Yeah,
like any government.
Yeah,
just because
exactly.
Of what ethnicity or religion you pretend to have at the top there, doesn't really matter.
They're not even real Jews.
Yeah, exactly.
Not even real Jews,
I
mean, so I don't even...
makes a great point on it. It's that these guys in Israel and what they're doing have about as much to do with Judaism as the Crusades did with Catholicism. It's really, at the end of the day, it has nothing to do with the average Jew or the average Catholic or the average whatever Muslim on the street there.
It's all a power move.
Yeah, and it's all trying to get people to divide and conquer against each other, because at the end of the day, it really is all about resources, money, all that type of stuff. I mean, wars have been started over sex, over trying to get somebody's woman. Wars have been started over money. Wars have been started over resources, land, whatever. But people, honestly, ideologies rarely truly start wars. Well, that's the window dressing that they often throw out for people. Reality is quite more base. And while it makes you less proud to be a human being, the fact that much of the stuff that is thought of as noble is not quite so noble, I don't know, you have a lot more of a realistic way of looking at the world.
Yeah, and people should ask themselves why, when the West failed to get public support to go and bomb Syria, did all of a sudden, there was a short, quiet period, and then suddenly ISIS pops up, and it's all over the media. I mean, are people not suspicious about that?
Oh, and the fact that ISIS itself, well, let's just get into that for a second. Why would a group that, A, Arabic Muslims, specifically Arabic Muslims, do not use acronyms? That's why, if you'll notice, all the names, even for, like, the Israeli Secret Service and stuff like that, all those are long names. Those are long names of multiple words together. They have no acronyms whatsoever. And yet, we here try and push that as that's normal. Secondly, also adding the fact that ISIS is an Egyptian goddess and would be viewed as blasphemy or anathema to hardcore extreme Muslims. So that also doesn't really make sense. And then finally, I don't know, as we brought up, why would they not attack Israel or have any threatening of Israel investments or anything? And honestly, why have they kind of played the entire game for the United States, along where with the U.S. is actually bombing ISIS in Syria? Is the U.S. bombing grain silos? Is the U.S. bombing hospitals? Is the U.S. bombing oil refineries that ISIS either was at one point or could be at in the future? I mean, they're bombing Assad's infrastructure. It's what they're doing. And the second Assad's Air Force really starts trying to fight back, America is going to call it aggression against them, and is going to try and just stamp them out.
Also, and this is slightly off the, well, it's on the same subject, but maybe slightly weird. But what do you think about some of the weird symbology you see in the media with people like Katy Perry? At the same time ISIS came into the media in a big way, she brings out a video, Dark Horse, where she's dressed as the goddess Isis. Is that just coincidence? I don't know.
I know some people do
whole shows on that, but it does just seem a bit odd to me. I mean, Douglas Dietrich talks a lot about Satanism in the military as well. I mean, it just seems to be connected in some way.
That Badondi, I think our good buddy Dan Badondi there does some great shows on that on Truth Radio as well. But the symbolism there all actually comes from the fact, and I don't know how much time we got left, but I'll try and make this as quick.
Probably, I've probably got to head off soon, so you're probably another five minutes.
I'll make this concise as I can. The average age of a Freemason, I believe it was 2004, 2005, was over 75 years old. And the entire thing of Freemasons, of Shriners, of all this, have no new blood, really. And they're all aging very quickly, and many of them don't even have had to close. Many of their branches and temples have had to close because there's literally nobody there. They've all died of old age. And I think that they're injecting all of their worship or all of their religious nomenclature, be it the Greek gods and goddesses and their pantheon there, the Egyptian pantheon and all that, and the obsession with the Sumerian or the Babylonian pantheon as well. And really, at the end of the day, it's all kind of the same deal, really. And they put that all together and then inject it into the mainstream culture as a way to, rather than Freemasonry being the secret path or whatever, they want to open it up to everybody. They want to open source it, essentially, and then have the whole next generation of occultists, the whole next generation of Satanists, the whole next generation of whatever enlightened thinkers come from watching their music videos or all this bullshit. Because, I mean, those guys that run that stuff, most of the record label owners and everything, are themselves Freemasons.
Yeah.
It's always something to think about of how that gets into the videos. And then you've got, I thought that was great too, as you notice, ISIS, the name, they just say it over and over again, ISIS, 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 ISIS.
Well, and then they change it as
ISIL,
well, don't they?
Or, yeah. But ISIS overall, they've said that. Just think of how many times in terms of an occult thing, at biblical times, if you wanted to show respect or disrespect for a specific deity, you would not even mention their name. You would not even have their name utter from your lips.
But now that, yet, that goddess name is being said about millions of times a day,
everywhere.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
I feel like, in a way, they're doing it for ritualistic purposes. Not to say that, you know, I don't necessarily agree with what you're saying, but I just, at the end of the day, when it comes down to all of these, you know, ancient sciences and knowledge that they deem enlighten themselves, in a way it could be used to enlighten the people in a way that it could be used in good, because, you know, at a certain point in time, you know, before these people stole this knowledge, you know, and used it for evil, you know, it was kind of common knowledge. So I don't necessarily feel like they're using it to give it to us, but I feel like they're using it in a way to try to gain more control and use it
to enslave people. Yeah.
Because
that idea, it's like the different steps of masonry and how a certain degree mason will get a different story of what the G means and all that, and what the true secret of Freemasonry or secret Masonic words. And I think what they're doing is open sourcing, like, to a certain degree, just enough to try and get people to open up that obsession with things like that.
So they may...
Because you've noticed people have become far more openly occultic than they ever have been at any point. Like, there are people that'll just drop some stuff on you that, like, you just, wait, what? Like, oh yeah, count to the Bathory or something like that. Like, that's cool. Or they start throwing up, I just know random people that have started throwing up, like, Illuminati hand signs or the pyramids and all that type of crap, and, like, we're an eye tribe and all this shit just because of the music. And it's, wow. Wow, but I do think that the ISIS thing also is to throw people off and confuse them, to change the name from Al-Qaeda, because people realize Al-Qaeda is the CIA, is the United States. So there was that.
There was also not to cut you off, but there was also a group of, there's a community of actually black individuals, which is kind of funny, and the leader of this organization, which was called ISIS, they have now changed the name since this whole heightening of ISIS, but they actually were, like, taking the necessary steps to be recognized by the UN as, like, aboriginal people of the land here on this continent.
Wow.
And it was kind of interesting to see how all of a sudden, you know, they're scheduled to have meetings before the UN and all of this stuff, and now all of a sudden ISIS is this radical Muslim group. And this goes back to the guy that cut the lady's head off, where it's the black Muslim paradigm in the United States that is being also, you know, it's just another peg of the, you know, the overall, you know, Kraken that we're dealing with, but it's always something that always gets brought into the scheme as well. And I feel like there's so many layers. It's really disgusting.
Oh yeah. I'd heard that lady didn't actually get decapitated. It was a double stabbing, or she was stabbed to death or something like that, that the media actually picked up the decapitation thing partway through. I don't know, but I actually would imagine that would be the case there, that it's not actually anything to do with radical Islam at all, that it's just like a stabbing that goes down because some guy's aggravated at work, gets laid off, and loses his shit. And then the news picks it up of, oh, well, he cut her head off. Yeah, he used a little, like, 3-inch blade to cut her freaking head off. And,
I mean, if you look at his background, he wasn't even a violent guy.
Yeah, like, some weed or have possession of coke or something. It's like, yeah, because you just go from that to cutting people's heads off.
It's completely ridiculous. He got into Islam 6 months beforehand, and after 6 months, he's chopping off heads. Sounds like he got manipulated or put under mind control or something, if that really is the case.
Yeah, well, before we go, I just want to inject here to back you up on that one. Of the feds do that all the time. There's a guy here in Seattle about 8 months ago, 9 months ago, maybe a little bit more than that, that was supposedly going to bomb the Space Needle and a couple gas stations and some stuff. But he actually was set up by the FBI with the fake explosives, the allegedly fake guns or whatever that couldn't fire and whatnot. But they set him up with all this and give him everything he can and then arrest him as the bad guy. It's kind of like entrapment, where they'll have a female cop who dresses as a prostitute or whatever and then entrap you and then, like, be like, oh, hey, you want to have sex for money, whatever? And then the second you say, yeah, they're like, oh, you evil, dirty criminal, or a narco agent dressing up being like, hey, man, you want some coke? And then you try and buy some coke from him, then he arrests you because you're the bad guy. And it's like, what?
What?
You're manufacturing crime. That's not.
Yeah, that's how all the terrorists have been caught in the U.S.
Yep, and I think that's exactly what happened with that guy. And, I mean, they could do that with you or I, of what they said of, oh, you have a prior arrest for pot or a prior arrest for a speeding ticket or something like that, or whatever. You have some parking tickets that you didn't pay. So suddenly you jumped from that to wanting to bomb an embassy or to wanting to cut somebody's head off. And it's like, wait, what? But half the people out there won't even question it. They won't. It's just, oh, you know, the government said it. So, I mean, he was probably that evil Corey Washington, that evil, like, black terrorist, or that evil Seth Davis, that evil right-winger John Deere hat-wearing frickin' whatever, you know, mud and trucks and whatever terrorism, America. I don't even know.
He believed in freedom and liberty. He had an American flag hung up in his living room.
Those guys in Vegas, man, those were the worst.
Hey, yeah,
the Gadsden flag and stuff. Yeah,
I was going to say we've had I've noticed a couple of beheadings in the UK as well.
All very fishy as well.
Yeah, there's a woman beheaded in her back garden last month. I'll have to look into it a bit more and find out more details about it. But it's certainly a bit suspicious. I'm going to have to wrap this up now, anyway. But I wanted just to thank you both for coming on, and
thank you.
We'll have to do this again sometime. Yeah, maybe make it a regular thing.
Every week or every other week or something like that. That would be awesome.
Maybe once a month or something.
Yeah, I'd like that.
Yeah, and Corey, thanks for coming on. Corey, where can people find out about your show, by the way?
You can stop by theaverageliberator.com, or you can also find my live broadcast Monday through Friday at 10 p.m. Central Time on wideawakeamerica.com or conspiracywire.com. We also got a, we're on Stitcher, TuneIn, all of that good stuff too. And they could also find my YouTube channel, just The Average Liberator, to find all the past episodes and interviews and stuff. And it would be great to have you guys on my broadcast so I can give you guys interviews, you know, introduce my audience to you guys more or whatnot as well. So, you know, it's nice to meet you, and I wanted to say happy birthday too, Scott.
Yeah, indeed. happy birthday to you, Scott.
Thank you very much. I'm actually going to go. That's why I have to cut this show short, because I definitely need to go out and have some local vodka just to celebrate.
Meet some fine local Ukrainian women.
I wasn't going to mention that, but yeah, you know. <why not? laughs> thanks to you both. And Seth, what about you? You're setting up the Truth Alliance, and you've also got shows as well and websites.
Oh yeah, you can find my regular news update and articles that I write, because I do quite a few original articles every I don't have as much time as I'd like, because I have to work a regular job and all that, be able to pay the bills, keep a roof over my head. But Two Real News, the number 2 Real News on Facebook. If you go facebook.com/2realnews, you can find it right there. And then I usually work with Pete of Truth is Stranger Than Fiction, and you can see that on YouTube, on Spreaker, or Slam Internet Radio, even tonight in about I believe 8 hours, I'm going to be on with them breaking down the article we were talking about and going over quite a bit there. And I'd like to thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with you, Scott. And I was very glad to speak with Corey, too, for the first time on the phone or whatever, voice-to-voice there. That was pretty cool.
It's mutual.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, guys. It's been great. And I'll get in contact, and we'll try and do this again soon. But have a great day, evening, or I'm not sure which time zone you're
in. It's all good, man.
It's nighttime here, so I'm going to go out and celebrate. But thanks again, and catch you again soon.
All right. God bless.
Have a good one.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Peace.
So we hope maybe we'll be able to do that from time to time, get together with two or three of us and have a chat about world events. Let me know whether you like those kind of shows, and give me feedback on all the shows really using the voicemail system. You can also ask questions on there, of course, about anything, and I'll directly respond to your comments. We're thinking of having debate shows as well, offshoots of this show, which I'll upload as separate episodes. So we'll call them Sentinel Debates, and we'll have Sentinel Chats as well. They'll be shorter 15 to 20 minute shows, which I might just separate. And I'll probably do some of those with Anthony. Let's go over to Anthony, our academic researcher, formerly from the University of Bilkent, now conducting further research at the AGU State University in Kayseri, east of Cappadocia, in the shadow of the Erges volcano.
Anthony, hello.
Hi, Scott. How are you?
Yeah, very well. Nice to hear from you again. How's things where you are in? Where is it you are in Turkey at the moment?
How are things wherever you are? I'm in Kayseri. It's a city in central Turkey. It's about 450 km from the Syrian border. Which is a very important piece of information to know nowadays.
Well, I was thinking it's funny how we're both sort of in near conflict zones at the moment, with the potential for things to turn quite nasty later. Here I am in Odessa, Ukraine, with a war going on in East Ukraine, and everything's fine here at the moment, but who knows what it's going to be like in the future. And the same with yourself. You were telling me that you know, it's not that too far away from some of the places we hear about in the news with ISIS on the Turkish border.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I want to talk to you tonight about Kobane, because I think, although it's been, you know, well covered in the mainstream media, there are some aspects of the story that aren't getting through. And yeah, Kobane is one day's drive from where I am now. So myself and my colleagues have had quite lengthy discussions about evacuation procedures if the Turkish government doesn't get its act together soon. But hopefully it won't come to that, because I'm really enjoying the city. You know, it's real Turkey. I mean, it's right in the middle of the country, and culturally it's fascinating, and geographically it's beautiful. We're living next to an extinct volcano, and it's a great place. It's a fascinating place to live. So I hope I don't need to leave, but there's always that possibility.
What I mean, I'm not totally clued up on this story with Kobane. I mean, all I know is that I've read reports that Kobane have been sticking flags up on the edges of Kobane. ISIS have been sort of claiming territory there, and there's been a lot of talk that there's been 500 people killed, I've heard. You know, there's the airstrikes from the west going on, but it looks like they've been, I'm hearing mixed stories as to whether they've been effective or not. And you've got the UN standing by watching, saying there's going to be a massacre. And then you've got the Turkish soldiers standing by, not intervening at all. So what's your take on it all?
Oh, yeah, you're right. I mean, all of those things do seem to be occurring. And part of the reason for that is Kobane is a minefield. I mean, metaphorically, literally, it may also be a minefield, but metaphorically, it certainly is. It's on the southeastern border of Turkey. It's just a few kilometers from the border post. And look, Turkey is coming under a lot of pressure over Kobane, but in actual fact, and of course we've seen this before and we'll see it again, the mainstream media is avoiding mention of anything that might cause blowback onto, you know, the countries that matter, like the UK, the US, and especially the EU in this case. ISIS have been trying to take Kobane for ages. They've been in there for months, but in the last couple of weeks they've really stepped up their efforts. And now it seems they have some of the town under their control. It's been kind of seesawing backwards and forwards all week. So by the time this goes to air, who knows, the town may have fallen. But in terms of population, it's predominantly Kurdish. It's being defended by Kurdish forces. Part of the reason why this has been such big news is that there's one country who could save Kobane, but it's refusing to help. And of course, that country is Turkey. So on the 2nd of October, the parliament here voted to give President Erdogan the authority to send the Turkish army into Syria and Iraq. And then the next day, Erdogan made one of his speeches saying that Turkey would, you know, fight ISIS and so on. But so far, what we've actually seen is nothing. He's completely refusing to send troops. We have also seen a huge movement of Kurds living in Turkey going down to that southeastern border and trying to cross into Syria so that they can help the Syrian Kurds who are defending Kobane. But the Turkish border guards have been told not to let them through.
Which seems pretty damn cruel, because, I mean, they could face imminent death.
Exactly. You do have people coming the other way, so the border guards are opening the gates to people coming from Kobane, so they can come into Turkey and shelter from the conflict. But you now have these incredible scenes, and the photos are really striking. Lines of barbed wire at the Turkish border, and civilians who have escaped from Kobane standing there with Kurdish fighters who want to go in and aren't allowed to, just watching the town being attacked and destroyed. And you've also got about 13,000 people either still in the town or kind of floundering somewhere between the town and the border. Now, this is really potentially explosive for Turkey. I mean, it's difficult
again,
to...
literally, maybe.
Well, yeah, maybe. I mean, it is difficult to know in this country how different issues are going to play out. You know, last year we saw Gezi Park, which was a protest over urban development, and it grew into a nationwide protest movement. But then this year we saw the death of Berkin Elvan, and that seemed to be a trigger for much worse violence, but it didn't come to pass. So it's impossible to predict what's going to happen, but certainly with Kobane, it's a very fraught issue. But I mean, in terms of where the Turkish government is standing, they've so far stayed out of the struggle against ISIS. You know, when the US was pulling together its coalition, John Kerry visited and tried to convince President Erdogan to get involved, but that didn't happen. And you know, there were some complaints about that, some nasty words in the international media, but it seemed like they'd more or less managed to get off the hook. But now you've got basically an army of fanatical militants right on the doorstep of Turkey, and there's a lot more pressure for Turkey to get into the fight. But basically, their reaction to this has really been just fuck off, or not too far short of that, you know. I mean, a couple of days ago, you had the Deputy Prime Minister accusing the international community of trying to use the Turkish army as mercenaries. So this has been the response.
I guess one of the problems is there's such a big distrust of Western powers now that, I mean, a lot of people think they're lying to a large extent about ISIS anyway, and that they funded ISIS, trained them, and, you know, there's a lot of lies involved in this war. So I think maybe there's part of that is the reason why Turkey don't want to get involved.
You're absolutely right, and in fact, we don't have time to go into it tonight because it's an extraordinarily complicated issue in itself. But when you look at the development of ISIS, it in part it developed as a part of the opposition to President Assad in Syria, and that opposition is very fragmented. It includes hundreds of groups trying to get anywhere near them and help them in any way, if you decide that, you know, toppling Assad is a worthy thing to do, it is a minefield. It really does, it really is impossible to sort out the good guys from the bad guys in that. And I think that some help has been given to ISIS, some of it knowingly and perhaps some of it not knowingly. So the US has been somewhat compromised there, and of course it has a long tradition of this, of getting involved with extremely dodgy people. So yeah, there's an understandable cynicism.
Well, I dare say it wouldn't be too difficult to check where all their weapons have come from and all their military equipment, and then, you know, if apparently they've got hold of some tanks and stuff. So how, you know, you don't just learn how to drive a tank in one night. You know, someone must have trained them to use those tanks and to use all this equipment, surely.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. I mean, and we've seen photographs published on the internet with, you know, ISIS militants holding open crates with weapons inside with "Made in the US" written on, you know, the tags on these
weapons.
That's
a bit of a giveaway, right?
It is. One has to, you know, one could say, if one were to be skeptical of this, that, you know, Photoshop is a wonderful thing. But going on past evidence, you know, some of that weaponry has of course flowed through from Western powers.
I think Hillary Clinton's even admitted that they trained these people. So a lot of the stuff, they're not even trying to hide it too much.
Yeah, no, it's almost a given nowadays. And that's one of the things that, you know, the public has been accustomed to over a period of time. We've softened and softened and softened the public to this idea of, yes, we sell weapons to people who end up being terrorists or who sell them on to terrorists. Now the public is almost jaded in that respect, which is really quite distressing, I think.
I think the public's jaded, but also I think there's a large majority of the public who don't really care anyway. As long as it's not going to directly affect them, you know, then it's not really an issue they're going to be.
Yeah, well, that's right. That's right. And as long as the right people make the right noises, I mean, you know, the international community is pressuring Turkey, and it's going to continue to pressure Turkey. There have been accusations that Turkey has gone soft on ISIS, and obviously, you know, in the US and in Europe, officials have to make the required, you know, concerned noises, and as long as they make those noises, everybody's okay. But in the meantime, you know, Turkey's getting a free pass, I think, and there's a kind of there's a very gentle approach being taken, where I don't think it should be so gentle. But I think there are reasons behind it, and I would say the main reasons are NATO and the EU. Just to insert one scary fact at this point, it's been reported, not in the West, that ISIS already controls about half of the Turkey-Syria border. Now, to be honest, I'm not exactly sure what that means in terms of what does control the border actually mean? But if it's true and Turkey has done nothing, then this raises some very serious questions. And I think that if the Western public at large were to take in this particular little piece of information, some of them might ask why it is that NATO is willing to risk the lives of its personnel defending a country that allows a terrorist organization to administer its borders. And you might also ask some questions about how such a country could ever be considered as a candidate by the EU. But, of course, the truth is that both of those organizations I just mentioned, NATO and the EU, they're completely morally bankrupt. And they're capable of doing much worse things than the current Turkish government. But the point is that even here in Turkey, which is often criticized for not having a free press, these things have been reported, whereas in the West, they're being played down or just ignored entirely. So I think this is highly suspicious and highly dodgy. But getting back to this whole Kobani thing, the town has been the subject of this siege because it's in a very strategic position. There's a border post right next to it and so on. And if ISIS can take the post, that's going to secure a major supply line for them, from Turkey into Syria. So it'd be a big win. But of course, a lot of people outside of Turkey don't want that to happen. And there's pressure coming from inside the country, mostly from the Kurds. Now, I think most listeners probably have some idea of who these Kurds are, but to briefly summarize, they don't have their own homeland. Most of them live in an area that you could call Kurdistan, but this area ranges across parts of Turkey, Syria, and Iraq. You know? And one of the very few good things to come out of the US invasion of Iraq was that Iraqi Kurdistan was kind of decoupled from the rest of Iraq, and it was allowed to govern itself, which it's been doing quite successfully.
And it was a relatively safe area up until this recent sort of ISIS situation.
Yes, absolutely. Given the autonomy to go their own way, the Kurds have made amazing progress, and they're to be admired for this. But in Turkey, they spent decades fighting for the same rights, but they didn't get those. There was a period of about 25 years here where there was quite an intense conflict between the Turkish government and an organization called the PKK, which is the Kurdish Workers' Party. It was something, I guess, vaguely analogous to the period in Northern Ireland, which English people call the Troubles. Yeah, and there was about 40,000 people were killed during that time. Now, in the last decade or so, the conflict has flared up again a few times. But in general, there's been a kind of halting process of reconciliation. And to be fair to Erdogan and his government, they can take some of the credit for that. But they've reversed it recently. 2014 looked like it might end up being the breakthrough year for this Kurdish question, as they call it here. But now we've got this situation in Kobane. And on top of that, Erdogan's been saying some extremely awful things in the media in the last few weeks. So for example, he'll just get up on a podium or on TV and he'll say that Turkey has fought all kinds of terrorism, including the PKK, the Kurdish Workers' Party, and ISIS. Or in a speech, you know, he gave a speech a while ago about the ISIS threat, and he said, you know, Turkey's more familiar with fighting terrorism than any other country. And again, he was clearly referring to the PKK. So in these cases, he's juxtaposing the Kurds and ISIS, often in the same sentence, and he's clearly trying do the Saddam 9/11 thing, you know, implying that they're of the same ilk and they're linked and they're as dangerous as each other. So it's a really nasty tactic. And the result of that may be, it's looking quite likely now, that this peace process that's been happening for the last decade or so is just going to collapse, which would be an utter disaster when you consider how many people died in the struggles that came before. In Turkey now, just in the last few days, we've seen deadly protests. The protesters are Kurds. They're furious to see that the government is doing nothing about ISIS, and when Kurds go to the Syrian border and they want to cross over into the battle and, you know, volunteer to risk their lives to protect other people, Turkey's stopping them from doing that. They're furious. And
I don't know. I think I'd be more furious if I was trying to get out of there and they were stopping me from leaving.
Well, of course. Yeah. And you know, again, to Turkey's credit, there's an open border policy largely, but I want to talk about that a little bit, and that has another aspect as well. Depending on which news sources you read, around about 20 people have been killed here in Turkey in demonstrations this week. So it's quite a fraught atmosphere at the moment. There's lots more police around and so on, hearing a lot more sirens. And we've also heard the leader of the PKK, a guy called Abdullah Öcalan, who's in jail. he's said that if Kobane falls, then the Turkish Kurdish peace process will be over. So things really aren't looking good now. And you know, Erdogan just keeps on going, blaming the Kurds for destroying the peace process. And so we've got the blame game happening now. And of course, as we've seen in Ukraine this year, the blame game just never gets anybody anywhere except for dead.
Here's a scenario, and I might be wrong here, but just it seems to me that Western powers definitely do want to turn this into a full-scale war and bring in the troops, even though they've initially said there'll be no boots on the ground. I keep seeing in the media just like little indications that you know, of people saying, well, we may need to do that, we may need to put boots on the ground. I mean, if a massacre was to occur in Kobane, wouldn't that be the kind of situation where all the military commanders and the world leaders would turn around and say, look what's happened, look at this terrible massacre, we need some boots on the ground?
Well, that may be true, but here's the amazing thing. As you alluded to before, there are huge possible humanitarian consequences if Kobane falls to ISIS. So the majority of the civilian population have made it out, and they're across the border now. But as I mentioned, apart from the Kurdish fighters, there are about 13,000 people still around, in or around Kobane, and quite a lot of them are elderly, so there are mobility problems for these people, things like this. And on the 10th of October, we heard from the UN envoy to Syria a terrible prediction about these people, which is that if ISIS takes Kobane, they will most likely massacre all the inhabitants. Now, there are two things about this that I find amazing. First one is that the UN envoy actually used the word Srebrenica, which just blows my mind, because, I mean, I'm sure most of your listeners have heard about Srebrenica. It's the town in Bosnia-Herzegovina where a huge massacre took place in 1993. Well, the UN basically stood by directly on the sidelines and watched it happen, I should say. About 8,000 Bosnian Muslims were killed. Now, to hear this word past the lips of a UN official means things are really fucking serious, because it was probably the UN's darkest hour, and it's not something they would generally want, you know, to call back to people's attention. So that was really startling, you know. His mention of Srebrenica was just just an indication of, wow, shit's getting really serious here. But at the same time, everybody's saying Kobane, humanitarian crisis, tragedy, massacre, etc. And the U.S. military command is, and U.S. Officials are saying, that's not a priority at the moment. Obama, you know, gets on TV and says, we're going in, you know, for humanitarian reasons to stop these marauding fanatics from massacring people. And then everybody's pointing to a town saying, this is where the next massacre is going to happen. And the U.S. says, not our priority. So it really calls into question why they're there in the first place. Are they there for humanitarian reasons?
Well, of course they're not. I honestly, any time I hear any government leader or government agency saying they're going in to do anything to help people, then I just know something's up. Because I genuinely believe none of these leaders care two hoots about any humanitarian reasons at all. Nothing they do is for humanitarian reason. There's always an ulterior motive.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. And look, in terms of, unfortunately, there's no good news on any side in this, and there are a lot of governments involved, and so that means, we're in a lot of trouble. Because this, you know, these 13,000 civilians that are about to be slaughtered at any moment, it seems. You would think that things really couldn't get much more disturbing than that, but they can and they do. Because, look, for some time now, there have been allegations leveled at the Turkish government that they've actually developed quite a cozy relationship with ISIS, because they see ISIS as being useful in helping them to achieve certain political aims. And these allegations are becoming more widespread now because, you know, you've got ISIS just across the border preparing for a massacre, and the Turkish government's response is indifference. So according to the people who are making these allegations, Turkish officials have even turned a blind eye to operations, ISIS operations, actually occurring on Turkish soil. So we're talking about things like recruitment of trainee soldiers and activities that support the group as a fighting force. So for example, it's fairly common knowledge that oil is a major source of funding for ISIS, you know, and it comes from several oil refineries which are inside territories they control in Syria. But of course, my first question when I heard that was, well, who's buying their oil? Who would buy oil from ISIS? And the answer is it can only be sold on the black market. And a lot of these sales happen in Turkey. So that the accusation is that the government here kind of knows it, and they're not being overly vigilant about it, basically letting ISIS get away with it. So if you read some accounts of what happens at Turkish-Syrian on the Turkish-Syrian border, for example, there was one report on an independent website called Al Monitor, saying that there have been plastic pipelines installed across the border, and not just one or two, but lots of them. You know, so if you drive up to the Syrian side, you unload your oil from a truck into the pipeline, it flows over to the Turkish side, and then into another truck, and the truck drives away and sells the oil in Turkey. You know, if there were just a couple of those, then maybe border control could miss them, but there are tons, according to this particular independent journalist. And it's not something that you can fail to notice, you know, as a border patrol organization. So how much of that goes back to the federal government, of course, we don't know. But again, it's highly dodgy. It's highly suspicious.
I think there's all kinds of dodgy things that go on most international borders these days, in even, you know, in our countries as well. Blind eyes turned so that, you know, for the trafficking of illegal substances or products or even illegal trafficking of humans as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember you had quite a fun experience some years ago on the border between Poland and Ukraine involving cigarette smuggling. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do. That was hilarious. I mean, just before we crossed the border, some people in the bus I was in stood up, started dismantling all the ventilation ducts on the top of the bus, taking, open them up, everything up, and then stuffing them full of large numbers of packets of cigarettes, then doing them all up with screwdrivers. Then we went through the border, and the whole place was searched. And I think the border guards, they knew quite well what had happened, but what they did was they pretended to find one packet and held it up, and you know, just I think it was just you know, a token gesture, and then they let us carry on through, probably knowing full well the entire bus was stuffed full of cigarettes, you know.
Yeah, and in that case, as far as I recall, quite a few of the passengers, maybe all of them, were in on it. Yeah,
they were. The entire bus were in on it. It was just me and my American friend who were actually sitting there whilst people were leaning across us with screwdrivers, dismantling the entire bus. Everyone on the bus was in on it. It was even the driver as well, and I'm sure the border guards were too. So, yeah, mm-hmm. I think it's a common practice that at most borders, all kinds of weird things go on.
So I think that's true, but I think when you start laying oil pipelines across a border, the border patrol should notice, right?
They probably should notice. Yeah.
So yeah, and you also had a scandal breaking a little earlier in the year, and this one actually did make it into the Western media. This was reported in the New York Times. The scandal involved a neighborhood of Ankara called Hacıbadem, which is allegedly turned into a major recruiting ground for ISIS. Now, reports say that as of September, about 100 people had been recruited from this one rather poor neighborhood. It's a place, it's not a pleasant place. It has quite a nasty reputation as a hangout for drug addicts and so on. But the scandal related to two things. First, that there was a kind of, to quote the Argentinian journalist who reported on this, there was an aggressive urban renewal project in the area. And there was only one school in Hacıbadem, and they knocked it down to put up high rises. And that left the local high school kids, without any community links other than those that tended to lead in the direction of ISIS. So that was a bit of a scandal in and of itself. But second, and much bigger, there have been some very public cases of young Turkish men returning home to Hacıbadem, this neighborhood in Ankara, after serving with ISIS, if serving is the right word. So it was public knowledge that recruitment was going on there, and the government had done nothing to intervene. It seemed
That's going on in the UK as well. I mean, people are being recruited in the UK, going to fight in ISIS, coming back freely allowed. This has been admitted by our government. They're allowed to come back in. They're not allowed to deny them entry. So it's a bit of a weird situation where these people can go fight, kill people, and then just come back into the country. You know,
it is a weird situation. But in this case, I mean, it, amazingly, I find this quite hard to believe, but it did happen. The president, Erdogan, and his prime minister, Davutoğlu, came to pray at a mosque in Hacıbadem a couple of months ago, which was 100 meters down the street from another mosque, which is under the ground, which is the center of recruitment for ISIS. And they know this, and they came and prayed and waved at people, and it's just incredible that this country is not holding their officials to account to a greater extent than they are, you know.
But more and more these days, you can actually say that about our own countries as well. I mean,
oh, absolutely.
Some of the incredible
absolutely.
Things. Did you get the chance to listen to the UK Prime Minister with his speech at the UN?
I didn't hear that speech, no. I've heard responses to it, but not the actual speech itself.
Just incredible. I listened to it, and I'm shocked. I suppose I shouldn't be shocked, because this was the weird thing. I'd heard this conspiracy theory that the government were going to come after truth seekers, like, I guess you could say this channel that I run is a bit of a truth kind of channel.
We're screwed.
Yeah, so the conspiracy theory is they're going to come after us. They're going to start comparing truthers to terrorists. Well, it's ironic, because Cameron stood up and compared truthers to ISIS terrorists, said he was coming after them because of these crazy conspiracy theories, which is weird, because by saying that, he just confirmed a conspiracy theory to be true. He basically said, yes, we are coming after conspiracy theorists. And you know, people can listen to this themselves. I'm not exaggerating. He said he's coming after non-violent conspiracy theorists, that more and more they're going to have to bring in laws to combat ideologies and people who doubt the events of 9/11 and stuff like that. It's just incredible. So basically he's saying that you cannot question the government's version of events. If you do, you are basically in the same vein of thought as ISIS terrorists. And they then another government minister, Theresa May, stood up and outlined all the laws that are coming in next year to shut down websites and anything online that's got anything to do with that kind of thing. So we really are going into a very dark time in the UK. I'm actually thinking of leaving because of it. It's just crazy.
Yeah, look, I totally agree, and I have heard this in reference to the UK, this idea of non-violent, specifically using that term. I mean, the people who are outlining these policies, using the term non-violent.
He specifically said non-violent people, and specifically said 9/11, people who doubt the events of 9/11. He did expand on it and said people who believed it was a Zionist conspiracy. He specifically said we're coming after non-violent people, which just seems nuts. But you know, that's the kind of situation we're in. We really are going into sort of an Orwellian kind of state now, and not enough people are angry about it. I just think it's crazy. I think he should resign over this. He should, you know, but the public should be up in arms. But people are accepting that because of the ISIS threat, these kind of measures are required. And I think what they're doing, the other conspiracy is that, you know, the ISIS threat has been manufactured, as well as partly the Ebola threat as well, to bring in all kinds of authoritarian measures, which people will gladly accept, because they would feel that, you know, this needs to be done because of these threats.
Well, look, I think the ISIS threat is real, but I think that there are certain political players who think they can manage it. And we've seen how badly wrong this can go. We've seen, for example, the US in Afghanistan working with the Mujahideen and the consequences of that. We've seen many examples, and South America as well. I mean, Central America, some of the people who the US started working with in Central America, these despicable people who they thought they could manage, and of course they couldn't. But look, I mean, you have to ask, when governments do such counterintuitive things, you know, when governments are, for example, giving free passes to organizations like ISIS, you have to ask why. Why would the government here in Turkey be so tolerant of a terrorist organization? And why would they seek authority from the parliament to go into Syria and then not go in? You know, it's crazy. I mean, there's no doubt at all that controlling the borders of Turkey is one of ISIS's objectives, and Kobane is a huge step in that process. Now, if an outside force controls your borders, then I would say that's a clear threat to your population. Can you imagine if suddenly the Russians decided that the UK was the next enemy, and they surrounded the UK with boats and said, well, we're not coming in, but we are going to control your borders. It's just crazy to not react against that. So you have to ask why. Yeah? And I think some people are asking themselves these kinds of questions in Turkey. But, you know, when you're dealing with politics, to get a real understanding of what's happening, you obviously have to look at the agendas, you know, beneath the rhetoric. And when we're talking about politicians, I think you and I know, Scott, that political advantage is always going to trump human life. Yeah.
Yeah.
So in terms of agendas, the first thing you have to look at here, and this is key to, I think, not only Kobane, but a lot of what's happening in this region now, the first thing you have to look at is relations between the president of Turkey, Erdogan, and the president of Syria, Bashar al-Assad. Now, there was actually a time when the relations between them were friendly. But at some point, they fell out in a big way. It's a long story, not worth going into now. But Erdogan basically hates Assad now, and he sees him as the main bogeyman in the region, or possibly in the world. And Assad notoriously said a while back that Erdogan thinks he's the new caliph. So these guys are in a slanging match, and they are public enemy number one to each other. And this is really clouding things. I mean, so for example, one upshot of this is that when the Americans come knocking on Turkey's door and saying, let's go and fight ISIS together, Erdogan's standard response is, well, look, we're only going to get involved if the deal includes we go and knock over ISIS and then we move on to Assad. And he's still saying that now. He's saying, I'm not going to go into Kobane unless everybody comes with me and then we go after Assad after that. And this is a really disastrous obsession for Turkey. And it partly explains why the government here may have given ISIS a few free passes. In 2011, Turkey opened its borders to Syrian refugees, and it started funding Syrian opposition groups. This is just after the big falling out occurred, and it seems like the move was partly motivated by a genuine humanitarian concern for these people who were under attack from their government, but there was a strategic aspect as well, and it's turned out to be a really problematic decision. It's complicated things here enormously, because in the last 3 years, imagine this, in the last 3 years, Turkey has absorbed over 1 million refugees from Syria. And not everyone here is thrilled about that. You know, they've formed a kind of underclass, you could say, in Istanbul and other cities. And of course, if you want to recruit soldiers for a fundamentalist army, the first place you look is in the disenfranchised underclass, right? So, It's been a very diplomatic time for Turkey. And also, some of the money which Turkey committed to the fight against Assad, I mean, they didn't just open their borders, they opened their coffers as well. So anyone who has a chance of taking down Assad, his money, go buy guns. And some of that money may have ended up in the hands of ISIS. And then, over this summer, ISIS effectively erased the border between Syria and Iraq. And after that, they started moving into northern areas near the Turkish border. And in those areas, Turkish countries have billions of dollars invested in construction projects, some of which ISIS are now basically blowing up. So it's a policy that's backfired on a monumental scale. But at the same time, these open borders have meant that a lot of people and a lot of hardware are flowing into and out of Turkey. And that means that while countries like the US and the UAE can go after ISIS, yeah, without any significant threat of, you know, seeing reprisals in their country, Turkey is now extremely vulnerable. I mentioned before, there's an Argentinian journalist who's been following this, and she wrote a very good analysis of this problem. She pointed out that about 6% of Turkey's entire GDP comes from tourism, and you only need a few well-placed bombs at major tourist sites, say in Istanbul or Antalya, you could do horrible damage to the country's economy because you could scare the tourists away. And in that sense, Erdogan and his guys, who have kind of banked on ISIS as being one possible way to get Assad, have really painted themselves into a horrible corner. But again, in terms of agendas, you also have to go back to the Kurdish question. So, I mean, I said before that the main force defending Kobane is a Kurdish force. To be more specific, it's called the YPG, or People's Protection Units. Now, these guys are actually closely affiliated with the PKK, the old Kurdish enemy, the enemy of the Turkish state. If Turkey lets PKK fighters across the border to join these People's Protection Units, of course the first thing they'll do is join up and try to defeat ISIS. But what will they do then? That's what the Turks are worried about. For one reason or another, there's been a lot of sophisticated German weaponry flowing into the region recently, and quite a lot of that has ended up in the hands of Kurds. So people like these People's Protection Units in Kobane have now got their hands on very sophisticated weaponry. So the Turkish government's nervous that putting two Kurdish groups together with lots of weapons might give them other ideas, especially
isn't
now.
Isn't this the story, like, worldwide, though? Like, governments keep funding groups who they say, oh, here's some weapons, go and help us fight these people. And then after that's happened, these people have weapons, and they think, what are we going to do now? And then they start turning them against the people that actually gave them the weapons.
Yeah, absolutely. And Turkey's leery of that, and I think they're leery of it because they've seen it happen to other countries, e.g. the USA. But, you know, in the meantime, we've got somebody in charge. Unfortunately, this man, Erdogan, is just, he just keeps making his speeches, you know, blaming Kurds for the recent violence. You know, it's a deeply stupid move, given the circumstances.
He sounds horrific, this guy, Erdogan. The more I hear about him, he just sounds like...
He is horrific. And I tell you what, though, he's in another corner now because, yesterday... We're recording this on the 12th of October, by the way, so yesterday is the 11th. Yesterday he had a phone conversation with Vladimir Putin, and it was a very interesting phone conversation, as reported by the press officers of both governments. The official reason why they spoke on the phone was to prepare the 5th Turkish-Russian Trade Summit, or some silly thing that's happening at the end of the year. But they discussed... They discussed several issues. The press admitted that, you know, there was some disagreement on a few issues. Apparently, the Turkish press said that Erdogan, you know, like, defended the cause of the Crimean Tatars, you know, and said, please listen to their concerns. I don't believe he really said that. But, yeah, I think the real content of this phone call was something like this. Putin is the major supplier. Russia has been the major supplier of weapons to Syria. They've said this year that they're not going to supply any new weapons, but they're still deeply involved in supplying ammunition and repairs to existing weapons. And you know, they've been an outspoken supporter of Syria at the United Nations. So I think the content of the phone call may have been quite tense. Because it's just not something that often happens, you know, like Erdogan sitting in his office thinking, who can I annoy next, thinks Vladimir Putin. It just doesn't follow. So, look, just but to get back to the point and just to recap, what we've got here is a government apparently allowing a terrorist organization to sell oil on its country's territory, allowing the same organization to recruit in its cities, not allowing volunteers to exit its borders in order to save a besieged town, killing members of a minority group who were protesting government policy, and then blaming the minority group, for those killings. And now, just to add a little bit more to that from today's news, it's going to enact a bunch of new laws against protests, so similar to these laws that we're seeing in the UK and Australia and other places. Though, of course, in Turkey's case, it doesn't need those because it's already, you know, one of the world leaders in violent suppression of protest. But then you've got a superpower who's been intervening disastrously in the Middle East for more than half a century now intervening yet again, and its leader is saying that it's doing this for humanitarian reasons. I mean, officially, the US are in there to stop this, you know, a murderous group of fanatics, right? That's what Obama said. But then everyone from the Kurds to the UN has now focused on this particular place where there are 13,000 people in danger of being massacred. And the superpower says, sorry guys, that's just not our priority.
It's because it's nothing to do with the reason why they're there. And this is the problem, I think. I mean, when I was we had an interview with Gareth Icke, and we were just saying, like, if people stopped joining armies and just said, no, we're not going to fight in these wars anymore, then it would certainly have an effect. But
yes,
and you know, I've got nothing against people who are in the joining the military. There may even be people listening to this show who are in the military. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, you know, a lot of these wars are nothing to do with fighting for humanitarian reasons. So as long as these people know they're fighting to further the cause of their world leaders who are in it for the money or in it for personal gain or in it for power. So the only way we're going to stop some of these wars from occurring, which are just furthering the cause of these world leaders, is for people in the military refusing to fight in any war that is not on humanitarian grounds. I can understand in the past people may have felt they were fighting to protect their homeland, but most of these wars these days are nothing to do with that. And that's the only way I think we're going to stop some of these things, or at least that's one way that it could be stopped. People refusing to fight for these non-humanitarian wars. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. It's been widely said, but unfortunately not widely enough, I don't think. I think there are still people who do believe that they're fighting for, you know, sovereignty and freedom and so forth, when what they're actually doing is fighting for the financial sector of their own economy.
So thank you for joining us today, Anthony.
You're more than welcome.
We'll be hearing lots more from you soon, hopefully. In the meantime, Anthony, take care of yourself. If you do find that the border does collapse, then you're welcome to come and join me in Ukraine, but we may have to flee here as well.
Two evacuations in the space of 1 week.
So we need to find a safe place on Earth, so maybe come with me to Thailand. If
Thailand sounds really safe, yeah.
Okay, take it easy anyway.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks again, Scott. It was a pleasure as always. I'll talk to you soon.
Okay, catch you later.
Bye.
Bye.
So always nice to talk to Anthony. Going to wind the episode down now. Just a reminder, you can donate on our channel. Always appreciate any donations. Remember, you can get a t-shirt if you donate up to £28, and you can do that in increments if you like. Just send me an email once you've done it. Let me know your size and your address, and I'll send them to you. You can see pictures of the t-shirts on this episode, or you can go to our Twitter page, and the first tweet on the page is has pictures of the t-shirts. They're quite nice, good quality. We can always negotiate, you know, if you want to donate less but you'd still like a t-shirt, just send me an email and we'll negotiate. It's not hard set rules, you know. As well as Truth Sentinel t-shirts, we've also teamed up with a t-shirt company who produce their own political t-shirts. So not that we produce our t-shirts in Ukraine. So some of the money you donate goes towards helping the Ukrainian economy, which is in dire need of it at the moment. But anyway, this other company, this other t-shirt company, they have some great political t-shirts at really good prices as well. So if you'd rather choose something different, then that's fine. You can buy a t-shirt from them. And we've got a special deal with them. They're truthtshirts.com. That's truthtshirts.com. And you get a 10% discount if you use the code when you buy them as TRUTH1. So use the code TRUTH1, a special discount we've negotiated with them, 10% discount, and every t-shirt you buy, you get 10% discount, and you automatically give us a £2.50 donation as well. So it's good. It's good for you. It's good for them. It's good for us. They can also do customized t-shirts, I believe, as well. So if you're going on a protest march or something, you can get something specially made. Remember, as Einstein said, blind belief in authority is the greatest enemy of truth. So I'm going to wind the episode down. Thanks so much for listening. Don't forget to come and say hi. Contact us on email, scottsentinel9@gmail.com, if you'd like to help with sponsorship. We've got, or for any reason, by the way, topics coming up in future episodes could include Fukushima, and we may do an episode on Chernobyl and other nuclear aspects. Nuclear weapons and nuclear energy. We might do an episode sometime on missing persons, on also on time travel, the Dyatlov Pass incident, religious cults such as Scientology, for example, anarchy, parallel universes, the control of scientific fact and education, utopia, thinking about utopian societies, Noah's Ark and the Flood, revolution, and obviously also our Truth Alliance discussions, Sentinel debates and Sentinel chats. We listen to shows such as Hagman and Hagman, Freeman Fly. We listen to Mark Cockin, John Gehry, David Icke, Pete Wicker, Sheila Zielinski, UK Column. Now, of course, the Average Liberator too. So, check out some of those shows if you're looking for alternatives. We're not in competition. As Pete once said, Pete Wicker from Truth is Stranger Than Fiction, we're not in competition. We want to get our message, basically, and start questioning events, which obviously David Cameron doesn't want us to do. Anyway, I must stop talking and get some sleep. So thank you again for listening. Catch you later. Goodbye.